Dennis Coralluzzo, do you swear to tell your version of the truth, nothing but your version of the truth, so help you God?
You fucking A, I do.
All right, let's get right into it. How did you become interested in the wrestling business?
Basically, I was a fan as a child. I grew up on the old WWF stuff promoted by Vince McMahon. The TV used to come out of Washington, I think, and then they had to come out of the Philadelphia Arena. I used to go to the Philadelphia Arena in the Hotel Philadelphia a lot, and I was always a big fan of wrestling. And then around 1984, I went... Mid-Atlantic Wrestling, Crockett's promotion, came to Philadelphia for the first time, and when they had them expansion wars, and YSP was doing a, WYSP was doing a big promotion with the Crockett's at the time, and I was standing by the stage with a 35mm camera, really nice camera I picked up, and I had my son with me, because I wanted to get pictures of him and the wrestlers, and the guy from YSP came out and asked me if I shot professionally, and I lied to him and told him yeah, and he asked me that. Told me they had all this equipment and tractors and trailers, like millions of dollars of audio and video equipment, but no one thought to bring a 35mm camera. And he asked me if I shoot pictures for him. I said, yeah, but under one condition. I said, from now on, every month when I come back here, I got a full access pass. And he agreed to that. And I met a lot of people through Crockett's promotion, guys that became my best friends and I dealt done business with for years, like Eddie Gilbert and Jim Cornette. Eventually Terry Funk, and while I was there, I made a good contact prior to that with a company called, that done the first two wrestling videos ever, Lords of the Ring and the Great American Bash, and a guy named John Berzichelli, who produced them, and his partner was a guy named Jeff Otto, and I got to be real good friends with them, and I really started out doing some stuff with Jerry Lawler first. We had the old Jerry Lawler feud with Bam Bam Bigelow. I met Larry. I knew Larry Sharp a long time, but I didn't know him personally. And he seen me at the matches and seen me around. We always talked about promoting, so I had an opportunity. They were looking for like a killer heel down there, you know, do something with Jerry Lawler. So I suggested the idea to him about sending Bigelow down there, and he liked it. We got to be good friends after that. And the first show I'd done was with him and his father, and it was at the Armory. It was like one of the You know, the Armory is a legendary building in Woodbury for having good shows, and we used to run there pretty regularly.
So the opportunity of meeting Larry Sharp
got you into... Opened a lot of doors, yes.
Getting into promoting...
Larry Sharp and Berzichelli.
Okay. How did the Larry Sharp and you form the WWA? What transpired?
Well, we were going to do our first show, and we wanted to do it right, and we wanted to have a belt, and we wanted to have a federation name. So we come up with the name World Wrestling Alliance, and after that we've done well with it.
What are your fondest memories of working with Larry?
Larry Sharp, I still talk to Larry to this day, we're good friends, even though we parted as far as doing shows together and stuff. Larry, a couple stories about Larry, he's one of the smartest people in the wrestling business. He's a shrewd businessman, he's very smart, and he's blatantly honest. I mean, if he's going to do something to you, he's going to tell you about it. He's not going to go behind your back and do it. And that's the thing I always respected about Larry. And I never had to watch my back around him because there was times where guys wanted to tune me up and, you know, inflict bodily harm on me. Larry Sharp was right there. And Larry is without a doubt probably, he's probably one of the baddest motherfuckers I've ever met in wrestling. He's a legitimate badass. We went to the same college together, but he was a few years ahead of me. And I can remember one day at the Monster Factory, when we had in Paulsboro, some idiot come to the door, and he called Larry Sharp out front. And he started saying how wrestling's fake, he's a fucking phony, and blah 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 blah. And he wanted to fight Larry right there, and Larry took him across the street on the high school grounds, and they took him down, and choked him out in about 8 seconds. I mean, Larry's a legitimate badass. Another funny time, I remember, he asked me to be a referee at one of his school shows up in Lumberton. And I'm in the ring, there's a match going on, and I'm reffing the match. All of a sudden, I stop and I look out in the audience, and there was two, like, factions out there. There was this one group of people that were fans of Patty O'Brien, you know, the giant leprechaun. And the other fans were from, they were fans of somebody else. And, you know, Patty O'Brien's gang always come to the matches on the bus and had two kegs of beer, and they were drunk when they got off the bus. And this fight broke out where the match is going on. So we stop, I start looking, the two guys are wrestling. Come over to the side of the ring, we're standing there watching. And Larry Sharp, it reminded me of like Joe Palooka. He was grabbing people and just hitting them one shot and knocking them out. It was so fun. He must have knocked out about 11 people. But he's just a legitimate badass. He was a great guy. I never had to worry about somebody, you know, never had to worry about my back being watched. He taught me a lot. He's one of the smartest guys in the business, and he's blatantly honest. He's a great guy. I love Larry. He's just a, you know, he's a good guy, and there's nothing more you can say about him. You know, a lot of people got a problem with him, but I've never had him. I mean, he's a shrewd businessman, and he was always, you know, up front with everything. Plus the fact too, he trained some of the greatest wrestlers in the world. I mean, look at the list of wrestlers that he trained. He's done, maybe with the exception of Eddie Sharkey, they're pretty much close. He's put more guys in that are stars in professional wrestling than anybody.
What led to your downfall between you and Larry Sharp?
We just had philosophical differences, and I had some problems, and I just wanted to go on my own, and he was fine with that, and he kept the WWA, and we never had a problem where there was ever real heat between us. You know, he was disappointed that we split up, and I was kind of disappointed too, but I just had to do what I wanted to do.
After the split, you became involved in the NWA.
Yes.
Why?
Well, I always wanted to be a member of the NWA, and I finally made contact with a guy named Robert Trowbridge, who was always the attorney. He was Ric Flair's attorney, and he was attorney for the NWA, and I called him up and I said, what do I have to do to be a member? And he knew I used to promote a lot of shows, and he met me in Philadelphia. And I joined, gave him the letter of intent, the money, whatever, and then he sent me the bylaws. And I read the bylaws inside out, and then that was probably the worst thing I did, but you know, turned into a big mess. But because after that, you know, the whole history with the NWA, how they basically, the bulk of the organization left because of the stuff I was trying to do. You know, I pissed them off.
I guess what led up to the bulk of the NWA folding or dissolving is around 92, 93.
Right.
Turner already purchased Crockett, and you guys wanted access to the World Heavyweight Champ.
Right.
Since you're all in the NWA, can you tell us what evolved from the lawsuit? You know.
Well, basically what happened was the bylaws, I read them inside out, and it said that any member has the right, being a member, to have the world champion for a series of matches. So I figured, what the hell, can you imagine if I brought Ric Flair to an independent show, what it would do? Well, I tried doing that, and they just kept giving me grief. They wanted to give me on, Thursday nights at 11 o'clock and all this stupid shit. And I just said, to hell with it. So I started putting pressure on them legally because I wanted to get Ric Flair. And then that coupled with the fact that they were going to switch the belt to Rick Rude. And the bylaw says the membership, the board of directors and the memberships have some say in that. Well, they were going to switch it without any board of director approval and any membership approval. So we took them to court over that. And that turned out to be a real joke too. So anyway, after all that stuff with the lawsuit and everything, 12 members decided to leave. It was all a clique of members. It was Sakaguchi and Watts and Crockett and Mernix and Gary Juster and all guys that were in this clique, and the 12 of them left. Suddenly left us with three or four members, and it. Organization was near dead, and I felt responsible that I killed it, like I did with some other towns that I ran, but you know, but I figured I had to do something to build it back up. So we had a meeting in Las Vegas. It was Crockett, Heyman, me, Steve Ricard, and Trowbridge, and I think there was one other person there, I can't remember. And at that time we got ECW to join, and right, I felt that was a good catalyst for us to get going because they were going to get TV and they were a good member. And at the time, I was friends with Heyman. I never had a problem with Paul Heyman up to then. I had a problem when he was Paulie Dangerously, not Paul Heyman, you know, who he doing as Paul Dangerously character. But we started getting things going, and then I turned around. I knew Howard Brody for some time. and he expressed interest in joining. He showed a lot of enthusiasm. And then he got in. We started building the membership back up. And the thing that really got it going was I had this brainstorm one time where Candido was the NW World Champ at the time. And he was getting ready to go to WWF. So I was thinking of someone that we can put the belt on that would give us exposure immediately. I mean, there was guys out there like Terry Funk and other guys that deserved to have it, but I wanted to do something different. And I was on the board of directors, and I recommended that we put the belt on Dan Severn because he was going to be good in Ultimate Fights. He had just finished, he just lost to Gracie in the one Ultimate Fight, and I figured, well, here's a guy that's going to be on three or four more of these things, and these things are the hottest thing on TV right now. So we put the belt on him, and then after we put the belt on him, and he appeared, he won a couple of UFCs. I think he beat the car off, and then after that, I don't know who else, he beat somebody else, but he went out to the ring with the NWA belt, and we went out to the ring with him. And after that, we had members like coming out the ass. We couldn't, I mean, we were back up to more members than the original. I think they had like maybe 22, 23 members. We had more than that. And so what I did, what I planned out to do, and then with the help of Howard Brody, you got to give him a, you know, the devil is due. He, you know, Howard's a good paperwork man. He don't know dick about the wrestling business, but, you know, he's good with paperwork and letters and being in the position of authority, you know, being the head jerk off in charge, you know. But
one of the questions. The night Shane Douglas threw down the NWA title. How did you or the NWA benefit from this supposed shoot?
Well, we knew it was going to happen, right? And I told Bob Trowbridge, I said, listen, I said, I don't think I should go over there. He says, look, you're on a board of directors, you're a member, they're a member. Until it happens, he says, you can't do nothing because it might not happen, but we think you're going to double cross us. And he said, well, make us out to look like baby faces. And that's basically what it did. And, you know, we became baby faces over it, and that vaulted them into a new plateau also, but that was basically the whole thing behind it, to go over there and look like a baby face, and that got us more members out of it too. Even though we lost them, we got other members that came in because there was members that didn't want to join because of ECW being in it, you know. So we wound up getting some local members.
Why did it take you like 15 cuts to get the promo right?
It didn't do that. It was maybe two or three. And it was because it was distracting. And the promo, I just done the promo to go through the night. I'd done what I was ordered to do. Mm-hmm. It was done maybe two or three times. And every time we tried to do it, it wasn't for me being stupid. It was like distractions or something happened, you know. That's basically, I think it was maybe two or three takes.
So the NWA or yourself didn't benefit anything from them leaving the group?
Other than the fact that we got
press out of it.
Press out of it. We got members out of it. And we had our belt exposed, like the NWA was back on TV, and, you know.
What were your thoughts on Paul Heyman doing this?
Well,
like turning his back on the NWA?
I suspect it was going to happen, you know what I mean? From that point on, it got to the point where when he first became a member and we had meetings and discussions and done stuff, I knew he was going to stick it up our ass, you know what I'm saying? Like it's, you know, Paul Heyman's Paul Heyman, you know? You're dealing with Satan on there, so you hope, expect the worst and hope for the best, you know what I mean?
I guess shortly after this, yourself, you tried to get some other promoters in with you to basically box Gordon and Heyman into Philadelphia, and I guess...
See, I was a lot, that wasn't basically it, I was a lot younger then, I just, like, enjoyed fucking with people all the time, that's, you know, my trademark. And the problem with Todd was, even prior to him leaving the NWA, and we're good friends, like, if you ran a show in Pennsylvania, he took offense to it. It was like he owned the state, and that was, there's no territories. He can come to Jersey and do something, but I wouldn't say nothing about it. It didn't bother me, but if I went to Pennsylvania, and the thing that really pissed them off, the thing that really got everything high heat with us, to the point where Heyman and me hated each other, was I'd done a show with a guy named Mark Bodie. I don't know if you remember him or not. Mark was the greatest guy. He was a promoter, he got killed on the turnpike. And Mark Bodie and me were real good friends, and I love Mark Bodie. He was a lot of fun to be around, and we'd done some stuff together. So I decided, I sat down and I said, why don't we do this? Why don't we do Sabu? Because Sabu would work for me anytime. He didn't give a shit about ECW at the time. And I said, why don't we put Sabu and Terry Funk together? That would be a hell of a match. And we'd done that months before they even thought about it. Well, then he was bringing Terry Funk in, Gordon, and him were bringing Terry Funk in. And so when we had that match, that was the straw that broke the camel's back because they were pissed at that. But Funk came in, Sabu came in, and I don't know if any of you guys went to that match, but there was it was a packed, you were there, that was a packed house, and it was a good show. And unfortunately, I couldn't make the show, even though I helped put it together, and I couldn't make that one because I think I had one that day myself. But that was the thing that really pissed them off. And so I've done anything I can to screw with him because,
So you guys tried to box him in and just...
Not box him in, it's basically just to fuck with him, like mind games and let him think shit, Because he used to get a hair up his ass over that stuff,
I guess right after this, there was an incident at the ECW arena where you and someone else were blamed for letting air out of people's tires.
Jabba the Hutt, you know more. It was me and him. Well, we were accused of slashing tires and letting air out of tires, but that really didn't happen. I know of an incident that happened to a specific person that was done by someone else, but it was just one specific person. It wasn't a whole, but it got turned into a big, got turned into a big thing that never did happen. It was just someone happened to see somebody's truck over there that they didn't like, and they fucked with his truck. They just took the stems out of his tires. But it wasn't me, and whoever done it to him, I ain't going to say who it was, but that's what happened. And then it turned into the... the St. Valentine's Day Massacre,
From there, then you're promoting NWA.
Right.
By yourself. Did you get rehooked up with Lawler and do a stint down in USWA?
Yeah, Jerry and Lawler and me. Jerry was one of the first people I met in the wrestling business. And me and him had a few problems over the years. And mainly, me and Jerry's problems were as a result of me being friends with the Gilberts, like the Hatfields and the McCoys down there. The Lawlers and the Gilberts, for the next 100 years, will always have a thing there. But Jerry's problem was he had a love-hate relationship with the Gilberts. And it was funny because, not to jump too far ahead, when I done the first Eddie Gilbert Memorial, Lawler showed up and made a big tribute to him. But see, now that Eddie was gone, and Jerry needed another Gilbert to fuck with, so he started messing with Doug. And Doug's not only like a brother to me, he's like a son. I mean, him and my son's best friends, I'm best friends with him, I'm tight with his family. And I didn't want to get in the middle of it, and Jerry got all pissed off because he thought I'd done a lot for him. I mean, he'd done a lot for me, but I'd done a lot for him, too. And I had a stint down there, which was probably one of the most watched things. It ran for almost 6 months, and he had me do some booking for him with Kamala and Pritchard, and I was like, damn, we had a good run down there because I had Fred the Elephant Boy and his brother come in, saying they were Lawler's illegitimate kids.
It was the Coralluzzo Collection Agency.
Yeah, and then because we were trying to collect child support from Jerry Lawler being an illegitimate father. But it was the funniest thing ever down there. We were down in Tennessee, I would take the boys, Fred the Elephant Boy and his brother, into a restaurant, and people would recognize them and actually felt that Jerry Lawler ripped them off and would give them free food. I took them to a record store one time. They'd come out with piles of records and CDs and free shit because the people felt sorry for them. So we're going over to Memphis down there. We went down a couple of days ahead of time just to relax, and people were like giving them the keys to the city. And then it culminated with a meet main eventing against Jerry Lawler at the Mid-South Coliseum. It was a mixed match. Mike Dorgendorf, who was trained by the Savages, came in as my collector, and it was me and him against Jerry Lawler in a mixed match, and then hit Dorgendorf with a fireball, and Dorgendorf had to go back to the locker room. So I was in the main, it was just me and Lawler left. It was great. It was, it was just the greatest, one of the greatest times I ever had. And I like Jerry, had fun down there with Jerry. He's like one of the best. I like Jerry Lawler a real lot. I really do, and we're good friends, and I've had a lot of good times down in Tennessee with him,
So we're some of
the. He's another guy that you put in the category with Larry Sharp as. If you look at the business now, there's like maybe only a handful of guys out there that have a clue as to what's going on in the wrestling business. And obviously it's Vince McMahon. The other one's Larry Sharp. Eddie Gilbert was another one that was brilliant. Jerry Lawler. And another guy who knows more about the business than anybody, he's not even in the business, is Dave Meltzer. Dave Meltzer has more insight and knows more of what's going on with wrestling than anybody. And, of course, Paul Heyman. I mean, there's like a half a dozen of them that should write a book someday on promoting professional wrestling. And Cornette, too. You know, Jimmy Cornette's just the same. But there's like six or seven of them that they should write a book on a professional wrestling, a manual, and let promoters, if promoters read it, they would be successful. Well, these guys all know the business better than anybody I've ever. And a lot of them are my mentors. I mean, I learned off of Lawler, Sharp, Gilbert. I talked to Meltzer. He's got a great insight. Cornette's, we're best friends, me and Jimmy. So I learned a lot from him, too. These are guys that'll give you, they'll give you answers that you don't want to hear, but they're the right answers. So that's the thing, you know.
So what was your fondest memory of working the USWA stand for, 6 months?
I like Tennessee better than any state I've ever been to. It's just a lot of fun. It's laid back. And it seems like when you drive, if you travel 2 hours, like if I go from here to a show up in North Jersey, like say I go to a Ricky O show or something, or a Tommy Farrow show, it's like an hour and a half drive. You know, it seems like it's 6 hours. But down there, you drive from Memphis to Nashville, it's like over 2 hours. It only seems like 10 minutes. You know what I mean? I guess it's with the people you're traveling with or the scenery or whatever. And just, it was a great place to eat and drink and have fun, and the people down there are really good. I like the people down there. I like Lawler and I like the Gilberts and everybody down there. I really didn't have any problems with anybody down there. They're all a bunch of good guys down there. You know, good old Southern boys, and you know, they're mannerly and they respect people differently than people up here do. You know,
I just wanted questions to backtrack a little bit. Gordon started out; it was him and Joel Goodhart.
Right.
And you're promoting around the same time. What were the differences in how you two promoted shows?
Well, Goodhart talking about?
Yeah.
See, Todd Gordon was just a backer for Goodhart. That's all he was. And I hate to say this, but Todd Gordon was like, I'll get into that in a minute, but Todd Gordon, I'll elaborate on him for a minute. He's like the rich kid in the neighborhood that if you played with certain other kids, you weren't allowed to play with his toys. You know what I'm saying? And throughout wrestling, he'll never be known as nothing but a big money mark. I mean, he wasn't creative. He didn't have a mind for the business. So that's his forte in the wrestling business. That he's a nothing but, he uses kids' inheritance to help Paul Heyman. You know, but like that's all, the only thing I can remember about Todd Gordon, he wasn't creative. I didn't think he knew shit about the business. And everybody that looks at him, that's his, people look at me and say, he's a sneak and a backstabber and a fucking, and they'll say shit like that about me, which is all true. I don't care. But like him, his moniker is going to be, he was just a money mark, you know? But Goodhart, see, the problem with Joel Goodhart, these guys, like, the thing with Joel Goodhart, which self-destructed him, was his ego. He had the biggest fucking ego of anybody I ever met. I mean, you know, it was incredible. Like, he was doing his thing in Philly, and I helped him with his stuff in Philly. And I was doing my stuff in Jersey. And he just got bent out of shape that anybody was running in the area, even though I was running in the area 3 years before him. You know, and basically, one thing about Goodhart, and I just pat myself on the back, but I was the first true original independent promoter ever in professional wrestling. Because I was the guy that brought the Terry Funks in, the Eddie Gilberts, the Stan Hansons, the Kamalas. I brought all them guys into this area. You know, I always had this idea that, you know, even though we can't get WWF guys, or maybe even some WCW guys, there's still a lot of guys out there that go through these promotions that people see and like. And they were the guys I originally brought in. I brought them in, you know, I had the Stan Hansen, Terry Funk, me and Larry Sharp had that Rumble in the River. That was one of the best matches ever in wrestling, and it actually brought together independent stars. I mean, from other areas of the country. I mean, like, you know, and I was actually the first, I feel I was the first guy ever to do that. I was the innovator of that shit. And Joel capitalized on it. He seen something good, and he started bringing a couple Japanese guys and Owen Hart, and I used to help him to give him ideas on what to do. I mean, Jerry Lawler, I got him involved in that deal, brought Lawler in. I mean, I was the first one to bring these guys in, you know, and that's basically, you know, he just, his ego, he could have been very successful. He wanted to promote the most violent form of wrestling ever. Another thing people don't realize, I was the first to have the Cactus Jack Eddie Gilbert match. I had that first before anybody. So, I mean, you know, but he wanted to promote the most violent form of wrestling ever. And at the time, he did. He had that, you know, barbed wire and cages and stuff that you only seen in Puerto Rico. He brought that up here. But his problem was he would have a $40,000 house but spend $45,000 on it. Because, I mean, he'd bring guys in, like, who didn't mean shit, like, nothing personal. At the time, they meant stuff. Like, he would bring guys like Adrian Street and Jimmy Valiant, guys that, you know, that you've seen in the wrestling magazine that you didn't really give a shit about. But he wound up paying them, like, $500 each to bring them in, plus a trans and a hotel and their managers. And he was shooting tons of money on guys that couldn't, that were great talents in their area and drew money at one time, but couldn't draw shit up here, you know? And that's basically what happened with him. His ego really, I like Joel a lot. I mean, you know, I've talked to him a while back. He was in the insurance industry. I don't know if he still is. But we had our differences, and, you know. But I like Joel. He's, you know, I like to see him get back in, but, like, I mean, you know, put a leash on it a little bit, you know.
Get back up to speed. You do the USWA. About this time, Ian Rotten's working for ECW. He has fallen out. Then you guys...
That was much later than that.
Okay.
Yeah, it was much later than that. Ian Rotten... I knew Ian Rotten years ago when he used to wrestle. He used to do a Confederate gimmick with Bubba Monroe, Sputnik's son. And Bubba Monroe was the best, and he had a gimmick, and he kind of like carried Ian with it. And then Ian hooked up with Axel, and they became the... I don't know what the hell they were called.
Bad Breed,
yeah. And then after that, they went to ECW. They went down to Memphis for a while, I think. And they went different places. And then he wound up with ECW. And then he had a falling out. And he wanted me to help him. You know, he wanted to come and help me and fuck with Gordon and Heyman, which, you know, I was getting kind of fed up with that by that time. And that brought him for a couple vampire matches because that was the hot thing right then.
Mm-hmm. I guess probably the best match you had him in was him and Pondo in the Four Corners of Pain.
The thing was a situation where we had maybe 150 people there, if that. We lost money on the show because, I mean, I had Brian Christopher, Doug Gilbert, Dan Severn, Jim Cornette. We had sponsors, so we barely broke even on the show. You know, there was only like 100 people there. But we made thousands of dollars off the videotape. And it was the most brutal. I don't care. Combat Zone with Zandek and all that shit he does. Nothing was ever as violent as the Four Corners of Pain match that Pondo and Ian Rotten did. I remember one time going over to Combat Zone. I tried helping Zandek out, you know, when he first started out. And I was a true friend to him, and he just turned into... He's another one that's got an ego. You know, I can know who he buys his mirrors from. But I walked into this building, and they had stuff set for a Four Corners of Pain match. And I looked, I mean, like, I looked at the one thing that they had the thumbtacks
in. The box.
The box. There was about 10 thumbtacks in it. There was, like, about a 2-inch strip of barbed wire in the other one, one broken beer bottle, and two mouse traps. And I said, this guy, I mean, he does this shit chintzy. I had 200, 300 mouse traps, 10,000 thumbtacks. I had, like, 14 cases of broken beer bottles, and I had enough barbed wire for a wrench. You know? And plus, I had a barbed wire baseball bat in the middle of the ring. And I told him before that match, I said, I'll tell you right now, I said, I'm not paying for your medical bills like I did the last time when I had him in Yardville. You know, and the workman's comp paid for it. But, I mean, between him and Reckner, that was even just as bloody. And it was just a straight-up barbed wire baseball match, bat match. And that was in Yardville.
I guess there's another incident at Yardville.
Yeah.
Probably stemmed right after this. That you and the building owner had fallen out.
What had happened? Yeah, what had happened was we were doing an IWA invasion up here, and I was bringing all those guys up, and I had the building set for a convention, a meet and greet with the IWA guys, and the show that night. Well, he told me I could have the building during the day that someone would be there, and all of a sudden at the last minute he got a bug up his ass, and I gave him a bunch of shit about it. And he said he wasn't going to have the convention because he had to do something else. I said, but you promised me. I basically, I'm paying you. We had a deal, and he just reneged on the deal. And I knew that night that was going to be the last time I was ever in that building. What happened was I knew I was fucked in that building after that point because I gave him a bunch of shit. And there was people that were trying to get in there behind my back that didn't want to do anything hardcore. So I figured, well, I'm going to fuck this building up before I leave. So I had a barbed wire baseball match with him and Abudah Singh, who was Balls Mahoney at the time. And during the match, I mean, Angel came out to the ring with, I think he came out to the ring with Abudah Singh, who was, you know, Balls Mahoney at the time, and she wasn't even out there 10 seconds, and Axel Rotten whacked her in the head with the bat, legitimately whacked her to the point that it cost me thousands of dollars for plastic surgery because she had, like, all these holes in her head. And then Breckner got his nose shattered. I had to pay for that. Well, my workman's comp company did, and Ian Rotten had about a million stitches in him. So I told him the next time I have him back, I'm not paying their medical bills. And that was just crazy. So after that, we were fucked out of that building. We killed that town and left.
What are some of your fondest memories doing the IWA, NWA?
Well, the thing that really I can never figure, and this is another guy with an ego problem. Ian Rotten, okay, he's another guy with an ego. I mean, he's a great guy. Like, if I sat down and went to lunch with him and we talked baseball or football or not wrestling, we'd be best of friends. But he had a real ego problem because the first week he went down there with the NWA invasion, he was lucky if he was getting 150 people at the Derby Sports Arena, maybe 200. And he had a good thing going because it was like a close independent type operation. Like, he would get in the ring before the matches with the microphone and talk to the fans over the microphone. They were really into him. Well, the first week we went down there, didn't know we were coming. I went there with Tom Brandy, who was probably the greatest heel in that area ever. I went down there with the Misfits, and I think Reckless Youth went with this.
Twiggy.
Billy really went down there with us one time. I had to get in that story later when I had his ass eat some humble pie down there. But anyway, after that week, we went down every week. We packed that place. You couldn't get a ticket to that place. We had a steel cage match where the fans hated me so much and the NWA that they actually tore the side of the cage down to get to us to fucking hang us. And he was doing pure business down there, and then all of a sudden he realized that he's not the most over guy down there now. You know, his ego wouldn't allow him to. So all of a sudden he tells me, I says, listen, I got a new angle I'm going to run down there. Let me bring down Ratchet. I said, because, you know, Ratchet was doing the gay gimmick, and down south they're the biggest homophobes, and they said that would really get heat. I said, let's bring Reckless down there. And so he says, all right, I said, look, he says, do me a favor. He says, get their plane tickets, and I'll give you the money when you get here. So I figured, what the hell, you know, everything's going good. And he was doing big business, you know, he wouldn't dick me. Well, the day after I get the plane tickets, I get six of them, he calls me up and tells me it's done. We're not doing it anymore. I said, what's the problem? He couldn't come up with an excuse. And then we're packing this place, so I'm sitting there with six plane tickets and nowhere to go. And he never gave me the money for them. He burnt me on them. And after that, he just, you see what's happened to him. He's lucky enough, he gets 35 people in the place. No one wants to see him anymore. You know what I'm saying? And it was an ego thing with him because he wasn't the most over guy in the promotion now. Now, my guys were Johnny, you know, Tom Brandy and Reckless Youth and the Misfits and guys I was bringing down there. They were taking more to them than his bleach blonde fat fucking ass. You know what I'm saying? And he got pissed off over it, and he just figured, hey, look, you know, these guys are stealing my heat. You know, rather than make thousands and thousands of dollars, you know, he'd rather get nobody there or lose money as soon as he's the over guy in the promotion.
I guess one thing you did down there, I guess, right after Princess Diana died.
Oh, yeah, it's a shame.
Why don't you explain what you did there?
Well, that was the, they had to escort me out of the building. I'll tell you the whole story, so I'm kind of embarrassed by it. You know. But what happened was, he got on the microphone. He had a good PA system, like he had wireless mics, and I mean, it was a perfect place to do good wrestling if he kept the feud going, because I had other ideas where I was going to have him come over to the NWA eventually and really get the people to hate him. And you know, like Tom Brandy, like, you know, he was the most hated guy down there, and he was the one that sold tickets. And he's out there, he says, I want to sell the Bower Heads now for a minute and pay tribute to Lady Di or Princess Di, whatever the hell she was. And they put the lights out, and I had a wireless mic in the back, and I yelled out, fuck that whore. And I walked out, and I said, that bitch would still be alive today if she wasn't sucking some Arab's dick in the back of a Mercedes. And they just fucking went nuts. I mean, they actually, he did not have enough police and security guards to keep the crowd off of me. They had me circled. I was in actual fear of my life because he had fan participation in his matches. These fucking guys there were weapons, light balls with spikes on them, and mallets with razor blades, and guns and knives, and you know. And I'm surrounded by these people. I mean, you got 12-year-old kids with a goddamn sword, and you know, grandmothers with a barbed wire, baseball bats, and like they're trying to kill me. I'm trying to think, what the hell? So we had a big riot broke out. It was just nuts. The police had to escort me out of the building, and like I'd be sitting in a diner 20 miles out of town, and people come up to me in the diner and recognize me and start fucking with me while I was eating. It was just, it got out of control. I mean, you know, I couldn't even, like, when I went to Louisville, I'd go off the plane, and I'd go right to the hotel, and I'd have to stay in my room. So they brought me to the building and brought me back. I couldn't even, you know, I mean, they wanted to kill me down there. But that was, yeah, the Princess Di thing. That was, it was kind of tasteless, but it packed his house, you know, next week, so.
You gotta tell me a Billy Real story from down in Louisville.
Well, Billy Real has always been like a son to me, and what had happened was he was always like a son to me, but he got a little out of control, and I stopped using him, and he was getting really out of control. I mean, I actually had, at one time, Jim Cornette sit down with him and tell him everything he was doing wrong to help his career, and he eventually listened to it, but he was getting out of control, and they decided to bring him down to Louisville. And prior to that, I had sent the Misfits. They were like my locker room
enforcement agency.
So I sent them to Billy Real's house to smack him around a little bit and teach him how to have a talk with him. And his uncle came to the door with a gun. And they had a gun. And it just turned out to be a freaking mess. So I knew he was going to be down in Louisville without any guns. So I had Harley and Domino stomp the shit out of him. I think they broke his nose, too. But after that, I mean, Billy Real's probably the top young up-and-coming star in the wrestling business, without a doubt. And he gets a little more size on him in the next couple of years, a little more experience. He can work already. It's not a problem. He's going to be one of the top guys in the sport. He's going to get a little bit bigger and bide his time. He's one of these guys that started out wrestling when they were 15, and because he's only 20 now, he feels he's getting fucked because he hasn't had a break yet. He's not to get a break yet. You know what I'm saying? He's still too young for that. He's got to realize that he started out when he was 15. He didn't start out when, if he started out when he was 21, he's complaining when he's 26. That's one thing. But to start out when you're 15 and complain when you're 19 or 20, then it's not, you know. But he's a great kid. I love him like a son. He's like one of the top. I got a lot of top guys I produce. I still got like an Inferno kid. He should be going to WWF. I got the Haas brothers, you know. Me and Jim Kentner are grooming them right now for the WWF, you know. Jimmy didn't want to use them, and I kept force-feeding them on him, so he brought him down there. And now I brought him down there with the idea so Kevin Kelly can see him. And he seen me, fell in love with me, want him up there. That's the same thing I'm going to try to do with Billy Real and these other guys.
The IWA thing, that ends.
Right.
Somewhere in there, like you said, Candido jumps.
Right.
You make Severn the world champ.
Right.
Now, he wasn't really trained in wrestling, I guess Al Snow brought him into the business. What was it like working with Severn, you know, so he understands the inside of the business?
The problem is that Dan Severn is the best wrestler in the world. Unfortunately, it's not professional wrestling. Where I think the WWF went wrong with Dan was they should have brought him in as a killer, like Goldberg, like WCW did, because Dan was a legitimate badass. But I think the thinking was, well, we don't want a legitimate badass beating our wrestlers because our wrestlers are supposed to be the baddest people in the world. And Dan was just never used right. And when Al Snow trained him, Al Snow trained him basically. See, Al Snow's a martial artist, too. I don't know if people know that or not. But Al Snow's he's into martial arts. And he taught Dan basically how to try to punch and how to defend himself against strikers, basically. And that was the thing. I think Dan, when you've been wrestling as long as he has, he was like an Olympian almost, and you know, when he was like he holds a record for pins in the state of Michigan. And when you wrestle for your entire life at collegiate style, it's tough to get. One guy who's doing a real good job with it is unbelievable. A surprise is Kurt Angle. Yeah, but with Dan, it's just it was never used right, and he never was really trained properly for professional wrestling, and I like Dan a lot. Dan, I mean, I love Dan Severn. I had some great times with him, too. You know, he's a good guy.
I guess another good story that I heard through the grapevine was one night Severn was in, and you were ribbing Billy Real that he was going to go over. He was going to beat Severn for the NWA title.
That was great, yeah.
Why don't you explain that story a little bit?
Basically, what happened was, if I get it right, he can correct me, but basically I told Billy that he was going to take the belt from Severn. And I think Dory Funk was there, and we had told Billy he was taking the belt for Severn, but Severn had to leave to go to the Fed, whatever the reason was, or something like that. And I sit there, and he's like, with the dry heaves and throwing up, and then when Dan Severn had a match, he knew Severn wrestled the first time. I told him Severn was wrestling twice, and I told Severn, when he come back to the ring, as he come back to the ring, I said, tell Billy Real that you don't fucking, you know, he's dropping the belt tonight, but it ain't going to be fucking easy, and he's going to take out his frustration on him, something like that, I think. And Billy's sitting there throwing up the whole fucking night, and Dan Severn's coming over yelling in his face, I know I got to drop the belt to you, you little fuck, but I'm not going to, you know. Anyway, and Dory Funk comes up to him, he's patting Billy Real on the shoulder and saying, no worries, it won't be that bad, he ain't going to hurt you that bad, and shit like that. And he's all, like, vomiting and shit, and nervous as a whore in church, and then he found it was a rib, and, like, you know, more than something along that lines, you know.
Let's talk about a few of your good ribs that you pulled. Just one night you had the headbangers in, and Eric Sims was giving you some shit.
Oh, yeah.
Why don't you tell that story?
Well, here was the problem. I was always friends with Eric Sims. He's the most hated guy in the wrestling business, bar none.
You don't think you're first?
No, I'm probably down to two by now, maybe three. I've gotten some, you know, some babyface sympathy lately. Well, Billy, Eric Sims got into had a problem with Jabba the Hutt, you know more? And what happened, Eric Sims, who I was always friends with and never bothered, he brought my family in. He got involved personally with it. He brought me into his problems with Gino Moore. So I called him up and told him I see him. I was going to beat his ass, you know, blah, 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 blah. Threatened him and told him, how can he do that to me? I've never done nothing to him or his family. And, you know, blah, dee, blah, da, you know. So at the time, Dapper Johnny Falco, Joe Panzerino, who was my partner in these shows, somehow was convinced by Eric Sims to let him set up a table. So what had happened was Sims had a table set up. I think it was at Ocean High School up in Ocean County. And these two little girls come to the locker room door looking for the headbangers. And I got these pictures of the headbangers. And they asked them if they can autograph them. And they said, they're nice pictures. Where'd you get them from? And I said, look, I said, they got them off Eric Sims back there. He's selling all your shit back there. Or they freaking flipped out. They went there and they tried smacking them around. And then he offered them like 2 cents on each picture, you know. Well, during the match, it was them two against, I don't know if Draws was involved or...
Yeah, I think Draws was there.
And somebody else, well, they spilled out of the ring and went over and they just like body slammed each other on his tables. And after they'd done that, about 100 kids swarmed like little goddamn rats stealing all his shit. So he lost like thousands of dollars in merchandise, and he was all pissed at that. But I felt some self-satisfaction to get him back that way.
Another good rib you had, right after Ahmed Johnson was released by WWE.
Oh, yeah?
You had this great idea that he was going to draw all this money
that's
and
my
bring
greatest,
him in.
That was one of my greatest. Well, what had happened was I brought Ahmed Johnson in. He was coming in for a card show, an autograph show, and I booked him for two shows. So I had my guy go up there to pick him up at a hotel in North Jersey and bring him down. Well, he pulls up to the hotel and he gets Ahmed Johnson to come walking out for the show. And my friend has a Nissan Altima. I think it was a Nissan Altima, which is a big enough Andre the Giant could fit in a Nissan Altima. He says, I ain't getting in that car. That car's too small. My friend says, Jesus Christ, Andre the Giant's been in this car, you know? What the hell, you can fit in it? He got pissed. He goes, you get me a limo. And my friend says, yeah, right. So he calls me up. He says, his asshole wants a limo. I said, fuck him. I said, tell him to get in the car, all right, and head down to the match. I said, don't worry about the limo. I'll get somebody with a bigger car to take him home, you know? Well, he refused to come, so I get there and guy comes and goes, bad news because he wouldn't come because he wouldn't get my car. I said, what? So I figured, I'm going to fix this guy's ass real good because he was like one of my headliners that night and he knew showed me. So I got on the microphone. I said, listen, I said, I'll be perfectly honest with you. I said, you know, we're doing a benefit tonight here for the CYO, you know, Catholic Youth Organization. And Ahmed Johnson was supposed to be here. But he basically said, fuck the CYO. And he don't give a shit about you fans. And they started, like, you know, feel the feeding frenzy coming on. So here's what I want you all to do. I'm just get a piece of paper and a pencil right now. If you don't have one, grab one off the person next to you. I says, and write this number down. And I had two ring car girls parading through the building with this number on it. I said, now tonight when you go up, you don't like to go to the bathroom or get something to drink or come out of a bar, call him and tell him how disappointed you are and him not coming here. Well, I went outside to use the phone booth outside, and there was a line of about 60 kids in there. I hear this kid go to the front of the line. I said, what's this shit about? This kid's going, yeah, you no good motherfucker. Dennis is a good guy. How can you do that to him and his group down here, you cocksucker? And they're cursing. These little kids, I was fucking laughing. So he hung up. So the next day, I had another show where he was supposed to be on. So my guy wanted to pick him up. And I tell you, he's the stupidest son of a bitch in the world. I mean, he's like, he's dumber than that goddamn glass of water there. My friend goes to pick him up at the hotel for the next night. He said, man, I can't make it. I didn't come to your show. He goes, I got to get some sleep. He goes, I was up all night answering crank calls. He goes, somebody gave my fucking number out. So all he had to do was tell the hotel front desk, hey, hold on my calls. But like, he's the stupidest son of a bitch on the planet. And then he called me up and he threatened me on the phone. And I said, listen, you dumb fuck. I said, you couldn't find your way out of Houston with a compass. I said, so, I mean, I'll never run into you ever again, and you'll never run into me. And I said, it ain't like it's Don Corleone threatening me, you fucking idiot. Well, after that, every time he comes up here, he worked a couple shows up here for Barry Geiger, I think, or some, and he always asks where Dennis Coralluzzo is at. He's still got this, you know, this hard on for me.
What are some other good ones that maybe I didn't dig up?
Man, I pulled a million of them. This is the greatest one. This is one of the greatest ribs ever. I went over, Jim Cornette called me one night. And every time Jimmy comes into town, we go to a restaurant called The Rivet. They got the best ribs in the world. The best ribs in the world. And we go there and we just eat like pigs. Like one time me and him went there, and our food bill came to $141, just me and him. That's how much we eat when we go to this place. Well, he says, listen, he says, we've got the pay-per-view in Philly tomorrow night, he says, and or TV, he says, come over to the Holiday Inn that night, he says, we'll go to the Ribbit. He says, what time do they open till? I said, till 12. He says, well, my meeting should be over by 9:30. He says, and we'll go to Ribbit. He says, can you make it there in time? Everybody knows, nobody drives with me in wrestling because I'm the craziest driver. I said, I'll make it there in 10 minutes. So I pull up to the Holiday Inn, they have a boardroom lit up in there, and sitting at the table is Vince McMahon, Shane McMahon, Jim Ross, Cornette, everybody can think of Lawler, Patterson, Briscoe, the whole creative team. Everybody. And me and Mark sitting at the car, and we're just sitting there and bullshitting my son. And we look, and we see them all in the room there. So we go inside, and we're sitting down in the lobby, me and Mark. And we see a local wrestling fan. I'll tell you his name. He probably knows I did it because... Dave Baumkratz. You know Dave Baumkratz? He's a little kid. He's like 40 years old and he wears a baseball hat. He looks like he's 15. Well, he's sitting there, and me and Mark are sitting there, and he's talking to us, and he's saying how him and Shane McMahon are good friends. So Mark comes up in the spring and says, Dad, come with me. He says, I got a great idea. He says, let's go and page Dave Baumkratz and tell him that Shane McMahon had him deliver sodas to the meeting. So... I go to the phone booth and I call the front desk. I say, excuse me. I says, can you page Dave Baumkratz for me? I says, he's a little guy with a baseball hat on. He says, hey, he's sitting right there. He comes to the phone and I put Mark on. He goes, hey, Dave, buddy, it's Shane now, your friend Shane McMahon. He goes, oh, hi, Shane, what are you doing? And he goes, nothing, buddy. He goes, I don't know if you do me a favor. He goes, I can't get out of this meeting. Can you bring me a couple diet sodas in? So he goes zipping down. I mean, it was like the Flash. He goes to the bar, and in the meantime, when he's in the bar getting a tray of diet sodas, me and Mark outside, we sit on the hood of the car because we're watching the boardroom. All of a sudden, you hear someone like a knock on the door, and you hear him at the door. It's Dave Baumkratz with a tray of sodas, and he goes, "Here, Shane, here's the sodas you ordered." And I look at me, and Cornette's sitting in the back of the room. He's like, "Fucking Dennis and Mark, I knew they had something to do with this." You know, they took the soda out. It was pretty funny. There's just a bunch of them. I can't even remember half of them. You know, that's the usual, like, you know, the shit pizzas and stuff like that, you know.
Here's an incident. I guess Amy Lee wanted to kick your ass one night.
Hey, I'm 1-1 against her.
Tell us both stories.
Well, what had happened was the first fight was I had a show in Pennsylvania. I was booking the talent for it, and I told the talent, don't mention anything about the show till I start doing the advertising, because it's in Philadelphia and Gordon had a hair up his ass. So I had this big show set up in Pottstown. I had Rick Martel and blah, 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 blah. At the time I said to her, I said, listen, I said, if you want to manage, I'll put you on. I said, manage Martel that night. I said, we got a gimmick we want to do. I said, we just got to keep it quiet because I'm not going to reach the advertising for about another couple of days. Well, her big mouth gets on the phone and calls Todd Gordon and stooges me out. Now, he's calling the building, trying to cancel everything. So I gave her a bunch of shit about it. I said, listen, I said, you're off the show. You're fired. I said, I'll never use you again. So I'm at the Marriott, and I'm sitting in the bar with Dick Murdoch and Terry Funk. And Amy at the time was a big fan of Dick Murdoch, and she liked Dick Murdoch a lot. So we're sitting there, and me, Dick Murdoch, and Terry Funk were in the bar. So what happened was, Terry Funk goes, come on with me, Carlos, I got to go to the bathroom. And I said, yeah, I do too, let's go. So we go, and we go in the bathroom, and then we come back out. And where we were sitting, Amy Murray and her friends sat down with Dick Murdoch. And we went back over, and like, you know, where's our seats? And they wouldn't get up, so I said, fuck them. Terry, let's go sit over here. So we went over there and sat in another spot. And Dick Murdoch was come over with us. So by this time, Amy Murray was half shot in the ass from drinking 25 blue Hawaiians. She was drunk as hell. So the bar closes and we're leaving. And it's me, Dick Murdoch, and Terry Funk walking out of the place. And she's walking behind us. And we had Gary LeJambre with us. I don't know who he is. He wrestles his big horse. He goes to Japan once in a while. He's a big motherfucker. Well, as we're leaving, she's going, I hear somebody going, Carlizzo, you motherfucker. You stole my date. I turn around. I said, stole her date? What the fuck? I said, listen, I said, Murdoch wouldn't fuck you with horse's dick. Leave him alone. They're just saying, because there was no sexual thing there between the two of them. She was just a fan of his. And I thought she was saying maybe I took him away from her because they were supposed to go out somewhere. She said, you stole my date. I said, fuck you. I said, leave me the fuck alone. So I go outside. Murdoch goes upstairs. Now, Funk goes upstairs with Murdoch, and I'm outside with Big Hoss. I'm standing near my car. All of a sudden, boom, man, I start seeing stars. She come up behind me and sucker punch me. Now, she's the first female in the state of New Jersey to have a black belt in Goju Karate, so she's legitimately, she's a badass. So I'm seeing stars, and this is the first time in my life I hold off and sucker punch. I just fucking nailed her. And then she starts trying to give me these windmill kicks. I'm catching her leg every time, dropping her on her ass, and of all things, having to be two guys from newsletters out there while the fight's going on, and security's coming out, and the cops, and all these people, and they're hooting and hollering. As I'm running away, as I'm driving away, she's running past my car, punching on the window, trying to break it. But the next day, she called me up like nothing would ever happen, and I just told her she's off the show, but that was the one fight I won. The other one was at the Eddie Gilbert Memorial in Cherry Hill. I think it was number 3. And we're up in this hotel room, and we're talking, and she's sitting there talking to somebody, and she said something to me, and I yelled something sarcastic back to her. And I didn't hear what Harley Lewis said to her. He said something real bad to her, and she got all huffy and puffy and steamed up. And she come walking by me. I thought she was leaving because she was pissed. But as she's walking by me, she sucker punches me again. I mean, she hit me harder than I've ever been hit by anybody. And like my eyes are rolling up in my head, and I'm trying to get my senses, and she hauls off and kicks me in the nuts. So I'm buckled over, and I'm blacking out, and like everybody's standing there, like in shock, like Tommy Rich and Doug Gilbert, like in shock. So I said, fuck. So as I try to get up again, she steps back and gives me another karate kick to the nuts. And this time, I'm sucking fucking wind. I mean, I'm out of it. I'm trying not to be be embarrassed by some girl kicking my ass. So like I'm seeing stars, my eyes are on. So I grabbed her by the back of the hair, and I gave her a headbutt. And I hit her so hard that I thought I missed and hit the wall. And she didn't even bat a fucking eye. And my eyes are going to roll in there. I am ready to go down for the 10 count. So I lean back against the wall to shake it off, and she kicks me in the nuts again. So I'm like, I have no breath of all left in me at all this time. I'm like really fucking. So I reached up and grabbed her by the back of the hair again, like choked her out. And everybody jumped in and broke it up. But she actually beat my ass that one time, so I'm 1-1 against her.
Are we going to have a rubber match anytime soon?
No, please. She's doing real well. She's being trained by Les Morgan. She was always like a valet manager type. And, you know, the way she would get heat was by telling everybody ringside to go fuck themselves. You know, fuck you, you little 8-year-old, and fuck your mother. And, but now she's actually being trained, and she's actually can grapple and wrestle real well as a lady wrestler. She's doing real well for these trained her down there, and she's doing real good. And I'm glad for her. You know, she's getting a lot of work, you know, like through Rambo and Dick Karakoff. And she works for other independent promoters, but, you know, she can actually wrestle now, which is good, you know.
Let's turn the tide, go back to Dan Severn.
Right.
Bring Dan in. He's a champion. I guess around this time, he's still doing the Ultimate Fighting, and then you have Pancrase champion Dan.
Right.
Ken Shamrock, where he defeats him.
Right.
What kind of waves did that create through the
Well, NWA it was very embarrassing for us because that was it was in Wyoming, and it was just Dan was basically didn't have the right people handling them, and I used to sit there and tell him certain things because I got to be real accomplished on shoot fighting because I watched a lot of the tapes and I watched the guys work out and hung out with the fighters, and you know, I got to be good friends with Shamrock and his brother, and that's when I met the infamous Tank Abbott, and what a fucking mess. And I kept telling Dan, I said, they know you're going to, you know, wrestlers always bend their head down and go on their stomach, because he knows that. So you guys just stay away from him. I said, and, you know, just give him a couple punch at him and just, you know, take him down and choke him out. Well, we wasn't even in a fight 2 minutes, and Dan ducks his head down, and Shamrock choked him out. It just pissed me off because he didn't listen. I actually told him what was going to happen, and the guys that were training him and managing him didn't know what the hell they were doing, I thought. And I kind of got really, it was like one of the low points in the wrestling business for me, because I liked Dan Severn a real lot. And to lose that way, it was just terrible. It was devastating. And but he has a lot of heart, and he went right back to the drawing room, you know, drawing board, and then he eventually beat Shamrock, which got him back his, you know, his credibility. But the one guy he lost to, he should have never lost to, and I think it was more devastating to him than losing to Shamrock was when he lost to Coleman. And that there, just I think that was the one that really
broke his spirit.
Yeah, because he should have destroyed Coleman.
So Shamrock beat Severn. Now, does that get everybody talking in the NWA, like Board of Trustees?
No, they were a little disappointed and stuff, but, you know, we looked at it that it was, you know, basically the demographics are the same for Ultimate Fight and wrestling, but, you know, I think the Ultimate Fight fans are a little more intelligent and realize that, you know, it wasn't a work, you know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
And that's basically, you know, that kind of salvages it for us, but, like, you know, Dan wound up with the WWF, and, you know, he had a lot of credibility and, you know, become popular, you know.
Then in one of Gilbert Memorials, you're doing Dan Severn versus Dory Funk.
Right.
Right. And I guess from what I gathered, the Funks offered Severn like $5,000.
Yeah.
Marty and Dory Funk offered Severn like $5,000
to drop the strap. They offered me $5,000 to get Dan to drop the strap. And, just never panned out, and I love Dory Funk. I mean, Dory Funk is a great guy, but and she'll see this tape and she can go fuck herself for all I care. His wife Marty is the biggest pain in the fucking ass, and I don't care. I feel she has ruined his career. You know, and everybody will tell you that she's just a royal pain in the nuts. And she disrupted that, Gilbert, and she disrupted the one after that, and I never had him back afterwards. I mean, she just, like, he knew we were having a locker room meeting at 7 o'clock. I told them about it. I wanted him there at 7 o'clock because it was important. He didn't show up till 8:30, and I kept calling his room, and they said they'd be right down. He never came down. He was there, hired and paid to sign autographs and do Polaroids. He didn't do one. Never showed up, even though he was there. And it's all her influence, and she's basically killed his career in Japan and ruined everything. That's why he don't have the dojo deal with the WWF, is because of her shenanigans, you know? She's a goof. She's a fucking idiot.
So
I love you, Marty.
So the Funks offered you $5,000
yeah.
to have Severn drop the
yeah.
strap. What was Severn's thoughts on...
Well, Stan didn't know they offered me $5,000. I just, you know... First of all, I knew she wasn't going to pay the money because she's an old wrestling con to begin with. But the reason I wanted Dan to drop the belt was because he was supposed to go to ECW. And that's what it was. And I said, listen, you know, I know you're talking with them now. You didn't tell me about it. I thought we were, you know, better than that. I said, I want you to drop the strap to me. You wouldn't do it.
What are your some fondest memories of working with Severn?
The thing I liked about Dan is, like, it's funny. My wife, my ex-wife, she never really liked anybody in wrestling, but Dan was one of the few guys she really liked when he came to the house. He would come to the house. He was just like a regular person. He wasn't, one of the boys, so to speak. You know what I'm saying? And he was down to earth. I mean, I'd done stuff with him beside wrestling. He used to come to the house. I used to hang out with him. He was just a great guy. I mean, we had a lot of good times together in a lot of places, and we always had fun, and we had fun ribbing and, getting the digs in on Phyllis Lee, you know, but, you know, it was pretty, you know, I had a lot of good times with Dan. I guess, you know, he was like a great guy. It was like being around these guys, you know what I'm saying? Like, you know, he's like a regular person, you know, even though he had that star status and that celebrity thing about him, he was just a down-to-earth person. He was very humble.
One of the guys who's probably stood by you through thick and thin the entire time was Jim Cornette.
Right.
Earlier on, you explained that you met him in like 84, 85
right.
during the Crockett years. How did your relationship grow? Or?
Well, the thing was with Jimmy, Jimmy was a fan before he was a promoter or a wrestler or a manager. So he basically had that sincerity about him where he was a person. And he knew I was a fan, and we just, like, hit off good. Like, you know, I met him through a third party that was friends with him, and we got talking, and we just hit it off good. And, like, ever since then, we've been, like, best friends. I mean, you know, we've ate a lot of food and traveled a lot of places, and, you know, Jimmy's just a brilliant mind. And always, he took care of me when he went to the WWF, and he's been a loyal friend ever since, and I've been loyal to him ever since.
Then he does... Cornette gets the permission to do the NWA angle.
Right.
In the WWF, you come out, you do the title.
Right.
You finally make it to Raw.
Yeah. Big net at Raw.
Do you think that angle helped or hurt the NWA?
I think it helped it, and they could have continued it and done something with it, but I think Vince Russo was the guy that, like, fucked everything up with it, you know? That's basically what happened. I think they got a lot of mileage out of that, especially with Severn, and they had Jarrett involved with it, and the Rock and Roll Express, and it was on an upward thing, you know?
What were their, I know the angle got scrapped, but you know, like, probably some of the insides, what were they evolve the angle into? You know, who else were they to tie in, or weren't any of those ideas laid out for that?
Well, basically, it was just they wanted to do stuff with Severn and Wyndham and... Jarrett, all the old NWA guys.
Mm-hmm.
And Jimmy had a good program for it, but unfortunately, I guess Russo kept nagging Vince McMahon about it, and they wound up killing it, because Vince was all for it, and a lot of the older guys in the office were for it. Like Briscoe, he's an old NWA guy, and they all were open arms to it.
Your relationship with Cornette still fine? Talk
still fine. I haven't talked to him in a long time, and I get a Christmas card from him every year, and he just... Dennis, no heat. I've just been busy. Jimmy right now, he's just a very busy guy right now. I mean, you know, I think he would think he's doing less now than when he was with the WWF, but he's evidently he's not. And I'll get a call from him one of these days. Jimmy's the best.
NWA starts to pick up. They're trying to, right. From the WWF angle,
right.
They're trying to explode it, bring in more territories.
I right. think
they're maybe pushing 50 different independent companies.
Right. We got more members out of that, too.
A lot of information went between the sheets where a lot of people are saying it's just a bunch of promoters that have no clue. That's what the NWA has become. I mean, what were your insights on it? Yeah, you're gaining membership, but is it becoming a tight-knit unit, or is it just collecting dues from other promoters
who
think they're going to...
I still feel to this day Brody kind of ruined it, because if you look at the board of directors, with the exception of Bill Barons, Ernie Todd, and Jim Miller, all the rest of them are either stooges for Brody or Fred Rubenstein. Like Slim Balcom, he's on the board of directors because him and Brody had a couple of private deals pending. Ernie Todd's on the board of directors, and he should be on there. Ernie bailed out Brody with the police in Cherry Hill. There was an incident with that where we had to cut $3,000. And Ernie Todd ended it up, and Jimmy and Brody lobbied to put him on the board, which was a good move because Ernie Todd was a Canadian, he was one of our Canadian members, and I thought we should have a Canadian on the board anyway. So Ernie got on, which I'm glad. And, Senator Inoki, him and Brody and Inoki's kid are so far up each other's ass that Inoki don't give a shit or even know what the hell's going on. And anytime Brody asks them to vote on something, they do it, And it's because they got deals, private deals going on. So everybody on the board, between Brody, Slim Balcom, Inoki, and Rick O'Brien, who's a fucking village idiot, Brody gets anything he wants, so it's hard to get shit passed by the board. And he's got, in order for the NBA, NWA to be successful, and they have to get a new board, let Brody just be the head paperwork stooge and get shit going. Because when you look at it now, if you look at their membership, with the exception of a couple of promoters, they're all fucking idiots. I mean, Bill Barons is the only one that's got anything really going. Brody started his Florida thing again, and they got a hurricane because he promoted more than one show in a fucking year. And he's a fucking idiot. I mean, he's a great guy. I mean, he's a good detail man, and but when it comes to wrestling, he don't know his dick from his ass. And there ain't too many guys that are members that have anything on the ball. Some of the better members they got rid of was me, Doug Gilbert, and Greg Price. And like Bill Barons has a saying, I was the best member ever in the NWA, and I was the worst. And it's the truth, because I just done shit that, just to do it, and get us publicity. Now there's not, it's a dead. It's like, look at NWA Jersey. Their shows are shitty. I'm sure these guys have been to some of them. I mean, the shows are the shits. They have no talent. They have nothing going on from controversial. They don't do nothing to generate any good publicity. Like, who gives a shit about fat fuck Gino Moore and his lasagna eating contest? I mean, that's real. That's like one of the top 10 events. And vote that in your newsletter. So, damn, those guys get sheets. Top 10 events of the year at the fucking lasagna eating contest. That's real fucking good. Yeah.
I guess during the 50th anniversary show, which you had a lot of insight help putting it together, Howard Brody complimented you on giving the NWA new life, and he said even though some of your tactics were quote-unquote questionable.
They always are.
Like, how did you react to those remarks where he's complimenting you?
Well, it's the truth.
Stabbing you in the back in front of everybody.
It's the truth, I'm very controversial and questionable, and, who gives a fuck what he thinks, If I gave a fuck what he thought, I'd be still in the NWA,
A little bit before this, you get with Todd Gordon.
Right.
You guys do the ECW Invasion Annual.
Right.
What were your thoughts putting that together, and what was the...
Well, I actually thought it was going to work, but then Todd went a little haywire. And see, I had always realized this, and I don't know why I went through it that angle. I thought that it would put a punch into the promotion. But see, you got to remember something. ECW is a magical promotion. Like, you know, you got to give Paul Heyman his due. He's probably, creative-wise, whether he'd done it with mirrors and voodoo or whatever the hell else he uses, he took a small company and turned them into the number three company in the country. And he still has them going. I mean, love him or hate him, you got to give him credit for that, because no one's been able to, I mean, he's had longevity, he's had all these years where he kept the promotion afloat and they're on TV. And the thing is this, is that I had always realized that if you take an ECW guy out of ECW and put him on your show, okay, you're not going to draw, because it's not the entire total package. It's not ECW. And proof of that is I brought Sabu in a few times. I mean, attendance was good, but you would think it would have been better. Like one time I brought Sandman in, you know, and he's a fucking idiot too, and I hope he sees his tape fucking drunk. I brought Sandman in for a show, you know, to do this NWA angle, this ECW angle, and for an appearance to sign autographs. It was farewell to the Sandman party. He sold 25 Polaroids. That was it. I mean, draw shit, because once they leave there, they don't mean shit. And all these promoters that come in their pants, oh, wow, I'm bringing Steve Corino in, I'm bringing Sabu in, and other guys for the show, Tommy Dreamer. They are the greatest stars in the world, as long as they stay in there. But once they leave there, people would rather buy a ticket to see their whole thing than to see a great guy like Tommy. I mean, Tommy Dreamer is a great star, and Sabu, and Steve Corino. I love Steve Corino, you know. But when you bring them outside of that promotion, they don't draw a dick, you know. It's just because no one wants to see them outside of ECW, you know what I mean? So that's, and so I should have realized that when we're bringing guys like Brian Lee and the Pitbulls and Public Enemy and I mean, Teddy and Johnny were a draw no matter what, but, like, they were probably the best draw out of any of them to leave that promotion and go independent. They drew better than anybody. But I should have realized that, you know, Kimona and they weren't going to draw outside of the ECW, you know, buildings and TV and stuff.
So for the invasion angle, did Gordon put up all the money, or did you put up the money?
I paid the guys. That was it. Now, Gordon was going around telling everybody I was paying him $1,500 a show, which I fucking wouldn't even pay Sid that. You know what I'm saying? So let him have his little fantasy and tell everybody that, you know. I'm not the biggest payoff guy in the world, so everybody knows that's not true, you know.
And I guess all of it finally came to an end at the 50th anniversary show, where you decided this angle's going nowhere.
Going nowhere. We're going to kill it. He took offense to it, and I had to actually hold Doug Gilbert back, because Doug Gilbert was when I actually beat the shit out of him. Because Doug got tired of shit, and Doug wanted to kill it, and he felt that, like, you know, Gordon was shitting on his brother, and it was just was going nowhere. And he says, Dennis, we got to kill this. And he drawing us a fucking dime. And I said, I know, let's just kill it tonight. And we wanted to change it to kill it, and he didn't want to do it. And he went storming out of there all mad. Little spoiled cunt.
Looking back on that angle, what do you think? Is there any one thing you could have done to maybe make it work, or is
just not do it?
That's what I was looking for.
Yeah.
Just your honest. Let's talk a lot about Eddie Gilbert.
Right. Oh yeah.
You and Eddie became friends, I guess, when he was in.
First time I met Eddie Gilbert. The very real first time I met him was in Philadelphia, and I went up to him to talk to him, and he was kind of like a dick to me, and it was just like we didn't hit it off at all the very first time. So I thought, see, what I had found out was WCW was trying to fuck him, and he wasn't too happy of a move. See, Eddie Gilbert, the thing I say about Eddie Gilbert and Terry Funk and Doug Gilbert. Doug's just a chip off the old block. You know, the fruit don't fall far from the tree type thing. Their guys, all three of them, are home run hitters. They get the bat, they hit a home run. But the problem is, as they round second base, they take off in the left field. So, that's, you know, you attribute it to that. They're just great guys. But I then went down to Memphis one time to do something with Jerry Lawler. And I was in the locker room or something, Eddie Gilbert was there, and I kind of was like standoffish against him, because last time I was with him, he wasn't too cool. And someone comes, hey, this is Eddie Gilbert, this is Dennis, and he knew all about me, and I said, well, I say, hey, so you're not going to treat me like a jerk-off this time, are you? He goes, what do you mean? I told him, he explained what had happened, and we went out to a restaurant that day, and we sat there for like 4 hours just bullshitting, and after that, me and him became best of friends. I mean, I was the first guy to bring him in this area, and, you know, me and him could just sit there for hours and just talk wrestling, and he was a brilliant mind. He was the best. I mean, you know, everything Paul Heyman knows and was taught was because he went on the road with Eddie Gilbert for years, and Eddie Gilbert taught him everything. And Paul even tell you that. Eddie was his mentor. And I can remember all the times when Eddie moved up to Philly here. I got him that job with Paul, with Gordon. At the time, me and Gordon done a joint show together, and he knew Eddie Gilbert was my guy, and he said, listen, do you mind if I hire him as a booker? So I went to Eddie Gilbert. I said, listen, he's going to hire as a booker. He's getting on Sports Channel, but he wants you to move up here. I said, what kind of money would it take to get you up here? And he gave me one figure, and I said, let's go for more than that. I think we'll go for more than that. And he did. And ever since then, Eddie was like, you know, indebted to me. Like he couldn't believe the deal. I got him the deal. And we became best friends. We used to go to Korean barbecue and sit there for hours and just... We hung out together, went to movies, we were just like best friends, you know, and Eddie marched to the beat of a different drummer, but, you know, if you knew Eddie and you knew his flat sides, you didn't have a problem with him. It was the guys, the promoters, and the bookers, and the guys that didn't know the psychology of Eddie Gilbert that had problems with him.
What's your most favorite memory of Eddie?
Greatest time ever I had with Eddie Gilbert was, and this is like... One of the best times ever. We had a show up in Wayne, New Jersey. It was the first time anybody in the United States used Sabu, and I used it. And I brought him up to Wayne, New Jersey to work Candido. And I think I had Terry Funk on the show. Yeah, Terry Funk. It was the first Eddie Gilbert-Terry Funk match ever. All the times they worked territories together, they never worked a singles match ever. So they were looking for it. So we went to the airport. I had my stooge, Gino Moore, carting us around. It was me, Eddie Gilbert, Terry Funk, Brian Hildebrand, John Bailey. Amy was with us, Amy Lee, Terry Funk, and we had like eight of us crammed in a van, and it was just the greatest time ever. That when I dropped them off at the airport the next morning, 5 o'clock, I don't know why it took us 8 hours to get to a two-hour town. And we got drunk and shit. Well, I don't drink, but, you know, when I got home that morning, like 5 or 6 in the morning, I said to my wife, I said, I'll tell you what, I said, if I don't wake up, I had the greatest time ever in my life last night. It was just with Terry and Eddie and Hildebrand. We just had a great time. One thing that was pretty funny was I was sitting there next to Terry Funk in the van. There was a beer cooler between the two of us. And Amy Lee was sitting in the front seat. She was passed out from too many Blue Hawaiians. So a song come on by Patsy Cline called Crazy. And he goes, hey, Coralluzzo, she's dead. I said, she ain't dead. She's drunk. She's fine. He said, she's dead, I'm telling you. I said, no, she ain't. So I slapped her in the head in the air. You know. I said, see, she's just drunk. He goes, she's dead. I said, she ain't fucking dead. What's your problem? So... What happened was he leaned across the seat and started choking me and smacking me around. I didn't know he was talking about Patsy Cline. I thought he was talking about Amy Lee. And he smacked me the fuck over his van until I realized he was talking about Patsy Cline. He's like fucking choking me and like, you know, smacking me around and shit. And I said, damn. I said, you know, Terry, what the fuck, you know? But it was just like one of the greatest times I've ever had. I mean, you know, it was just a great time. That was probably one of the greatest times ever on the road. It was with them guys.
You helped Eddie get in to work for Todd.
Right.
To be the booker.
Right.
And I guess you stayed in contact with him that whole time.
Oh, the whole time. We just go out three, 4 times a week. He'd tell me what Todd was up to, and I'd tell him what I was up to, and he'd try to, you know.
Find a medium.
Yeah, he'd laugh and tell me what to do and what not to do to make it work, you know? It was just funny shit.
What led to his demise with Gordon, do you feel?
Well, what had happened, Todd let Paul Heyman and I believe Kevin Sullivan and guys like that get to his ear. You know what I'm saying? And they basically started to cause the demise of Eddie Gilbert with ECW because Heyman, who was Gilbert's best friend, was going behind Heyman, Gilbert's back and saying, Todd, you got to do this, you got to do that. And fucking Kevin Sullivan's trying to fuck Eddie at his job and Heyman's trying to fuck Eddie at a job and everybody's trying to fuck everybody. So they went to Gordon behind Doug's back, and that's just because you hear so much about somebody bad shit all the time, you're going to start thinking that it is true. And Gordon should have just, well, Gordon should have just, like, you know, stuck with Eddie. I mean, the success Paul has, but I think Eddie could have eventually gotten that same success, because when talking to Eddie, he was going to do a lot of that real hardcore shit eventually, because Gordon kept saying, oh, we're not going to do what Joel Goodhart did. But Eddie knew he was going to have to do that to get the crowds in there. And then they got rid of Eddie, and that was it. You know?
Eddie leaves, and I guess then he comes to you, or he helps run your stuff for a little
bit?
Well,
no. My situation with Eddie was, I would always bring him in to work independent shots for me anyway. And then when he would come in early and we'd sit down and map out. So he really did kind of help me with angles and stuff like that. But after the ECW thing, that really hurt him bad. And he kind of like disappeared. He wasn't doing much. Then I had the NWA World Championship tournament. And I brought him in for that. And he was at top physical condition at the time. I mean, you know, he worked with pins in his fingers. A cast. I mean, he was, you know, his fingers were broken. He worked, went out there and worked his ass off. And then I was going to Jim Cornette all the time and saying, Jim, he's at the peak of his
game
right now. Why don't you bring him in and use him just one time? Do it for me for old time's sake. I said, the guy's got shit going good for him now. And he said, I don't know, I don't want to do it, you know, blah, 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 you know, the history, and just, you know. I said, look, Jimmy, I'm telling you, he's fucking great right now. I said, give him for me, just bring him in one TV tape and see how he goes. Well, he brought him in, and Kane, Glenn Jacobs, is a Unabomber, and it just started to tear the place apart. It was fucking great. Eddie done great interviews. He was showing up all the time. He was doing shit. So I was so glad that it worked out because I recommended Jimmy to use him. So, I called Eddie Gilbert up, and I said, listen, I'm coming down to Knoxville, this big show Cornette's having, I want to see you down there, we'll hang out, I'm glad you're doing good. So I come down to Knoxville, and Gilbert ain't there. I asked him, I said, where the fuck's Eddie at? And he said, well, he went to Puerto Rico to be the booker. I said, oh, man, I can't believe this. I can't. And I called his father, I said, Tommy, what the fuck? I said, you know, he said, Dad, I don't know what to tell you. He says, he's in Puerto Rico, you know. And then after that, I think I talked to him one time after that when he was in Puerto Rico, and he apologized for missing, you know, and he just had to do this move because, you know, it was just something he had to do. And then after that, he just died, and that was the last I ever heard from him.
How did you get word of his death?
Well, a lot of people I know went down to Baltimore for a show with WCW, and I had heard, someone called me up at the house and he said, Dennis, he said, check this out, I hate to tell you this, but he said, I think Eddie Gilbert's dead. I said, get the hell out, really? So I checked it out and found out it was true. And then a lot of people heard about it in Baltimore, and like, when I got back late that night from the show, were calling me, I already known about it. And I tried calling his mother and father and shit to find out what was going on, and they were really, and then I went down to the funeral with Terry Funk, me and him went down together. And it was the most incredible funeral I ever went to in my life. Unbelievable. Like that, you know, it was just incredible. All the people were there, and, you know, they had like a funeral procession from the funeral parlor to the church. I mean, it was on foot, you know, and Terry Funk was like leading the whole crowd, and it was just like, you know, he was like the head honorary pallbearer or something, but he didn't have to carry the think Lawler was there, and Christopher, and everybody ever worked in Memphis, pretty much. You know, it was like a who's who of wrestling.
After that, where did you get the idea to do the memorial show? Really, before then, there was nothing, and now it's like...
I know. Nobody done memorial shows until I'd done that one. Did you notice that?
I'm giving you credit.
Yeah, I done that. Well, what had happened was his mom had a thing in a newsletter that she was trying to get to start a scholarship fund for Eddie down at Lexington High School in Tennessee, and she was looking for donations. So I called her up and I just threw the idea bar. I said, Peggy, let's do a memorial up here. Eddie was more popular in this area than anywhere. He was just as popular up here as he was down in, matter of fact, he was probably more popular up here than he was in Memphis. And they thought it was a good idea. It was a great idea. And the first one we had was at the in Cherry Hill. But unfortunately, we got like about 18 inches of snow. And still turned out to be a big money maker for the scholarship fund because people bought tickets that didn't come, and we had ads and all kinds of stuff. And the thing that was great about it was I was standing there, and I had heat with Cactus Jack, major heat, because I was fucking with ECW at the time on a continual regular basis where I was actually having shows canceled on them, you know. But, you know, and I was standing there, and I'm talking on the microphone. I look over, and Cactus Jack comes walking. And he comes up to me, and we got talking. I said, man, is the heat over? And shit, he says, yeah. He says, you know, and he was going with the WWF at the time, and he showed up, and Lawler was there, and Cornette, and everybody could think it was there. It was a great time, and that we continued every year. The mistake I made this year, I had it down in Vineland, and, you know, I was like, that's the worst place to do anything. I'm going to do another one in the fall, I think, but I'm just going to have the show. I'm not going to have the luncheon or the convention or any of that shit.
What are some of your fondest memories of, we'll just do it year by year, the first Gilbert Memorial. Like, how easy, or were there any difficulties bringing all the different guys in?
No, it's really, if you do this shit for so long, it's like a science. You just pick up the phone, you call the guy, you book him, you tell him you want to pay him, tell him what it's for, and ask him what city he's flying out of. And all you got to do after that is call the airline, get the ticket. It's like it was a no-brainer.
But, I mean, you had some guys there that had bad blood with Eddie. You know, like
the only person there that had bad blood with Eddie was Lawler. But Jerry was professional enough and honest enough to realize that Gilbert made him money down there. Mm-hmm. And he come up and he gave a good tribute to him, and it was fine. I didn't really have anybody there any controversy or problems. And there was problems with me and Cactus Jack at the time.
How did that stem?
From me getting shows canceled for ECW. Like, you know, calling up buildings and telling them I was like special interest groups that were offended by the type of product, you know. We would have a protest out there, like the Nation of Islam and the Southern Baptist Leadership Council and shit. You know, fake, you know. There's some funny shit, though, you know.
How many times did you do that?
About 4 or 5. And Cactus came in, so I felt bad for him because he had a family and was trying to make money. And I had a great batting average going. They come in one weekend for 3 shows, and at the last minute I had 2 of them canceled. And he called me up cursing at me on the phone and shit, and acting like I was the heel, you know. I had a big fight with him on the phone. I told him I was going to fucking shoot him. And that was the last, you know.
So everybody knew that you were behind it.
Yeah. You know, it was funny you mentioned that. The very first benefit show ever I did, the one that really, I got all the glitches and learned how to do it, and it was the most successful one, was the Tom Robinson Memorial. Not Memorial, the Tom Robinson benefit. Mm-hmm. Here's a guy that had some kind of rare disease that nobody knew what it was, and he went from like 170 pounds down to 85 pounds. He was actually dying. And he wasn't getting his medical bills paid. So I threw this benefit over at this Catholic high school in Pennsylvania. And if you remember, it was probably one of the greatest independent shows ever because I had Funk. I had the Midnights against Funk and Cactus Jack. But somehow Bobby Eaton got hurt, so I had Eddie Gilbert replace him. And I had Jerry Lawler there against... Was Jerry Lawler against Bob Backlund? Who was it? I had Lawler on the show, which is a great card, I can't remember, but that was the very first benefit that was ever done for anybody in wrestling, like a show to help someone. I mean, you have shows for cancer and cops and firemen and shit like that, but this was the first one to help somebody that was actually known and well-liked in the wrestling business. And Nath and I started doing the Daddy Gilbert ones, you know.
Mm-hmm. Talk about how you tried to basically get ECW out of business by canceling shows.
Right.
What was your main drive? Or,
well, it was just the idea that they basically started all this shit because I had some good sponsors and buildings in Pennsylvania. And every time I would want to run over there or do something over there, he acted like he was the emperor of Pennsylvania. And he tried fucking with me over there. But his problem was, he's a super flyweight, and I'm a super heavyweight when it comes to fucking with people. You know, and he didn't realize that, you know. So the more he got my ass up in the air, the more shit I did to him, you know.
What's two or three of your top stories of fucking with them? Fondest memories?
I actually had a building canceled on him down in Mississippi somewhere. I called up and I was the head of the Southern Christian some bullshit group. I had a major protest playing with 4,000 marchers. And the best one was Cheney State when I called up as the NAACP and had that canceled. Right, but they were like, you know, two of the, there's just a bunch of them, you know.
Anything else other than like trying to get their shows canceled, working with trying to get them kicked off TV?
You know what? The TV thing, I'm trying to remember what happened with that. That wasn't me that really tried to get them kicked off. It was, I think it was Gino Moore that tried that, and had them get kicked off of TV. He was the one that called Sports Channel and actually had them that close. But, you know, it's bullshit, you know. Gino was a minor leaguer, so, you know, he had enough. You should have let me handle it. I would have had him off of TV. Yeah, just remember that stuff. That stuff, when you bring it back, it brings back fond memories of fucking with ECW, you know. But they almost got, Gino almost got them actually canceled off of TV. Hey, let's take a break, all right?
We left off talking about some of the Gilbert memorials. I guess probably the most sentimental moment is when Buddy Landell broke down. I mean, what are your thoughts on
that? Well, my thoughts? I love Buddy Landell, but Buddy Landell's so full of bullshit. It's a fucking incredible. He just, he did like Eddie, and he loved Eddie, and he broke down. But sometimes, I don't know whether it's the natural breakdown or to chemicals, you know what I'm saying? But Buddy had a falling out with him. I'd like to bring him back because Buddy's, you know, Buddy's the biggest fucking con in wrestling. But I love the guy. I mean, nothing. I have no ill feelings for Buddy Landell other than the fact that he's a fucking con man and a liar, and he hides behind the Lord when he does it.
Being involved in the business, you had a Pennsylvania license, state of Pennsylvania, you need a right. Wrestling license to run shows. I guess probably one of your favorite moments was the Angel ran the Rock and Wrestling show.
Oh, jeez.
Go over that story.
That was the, when I tell people about this, they do not believe it happened, but for the 300 or 400 people who were there that seen it, there's a tape floating around somewhere. I got to get off a guy named Jim Morianos. He used to do a lot of taping for wrestling. Well, Cosmic Commander calls up and asks me if he can use my license. Him and Angel are doing a show at the Northern Liberties Rec Center. So I figure, what the hell? Based on their track record there, they'll probably have 15, 20 people. Well, I pull up to the place. I see motorcycles outside. I could not believe what I seen when I went inside. The place was packed. I mean, it was packed with bikers, skinheads, Nazis, punk rockers. If you took the 350 people in there that night and you put them on a football field and you had them take on the entire ECW arena, you know, which is like one big built, you know, one big accumulation of welfare recipients, and you had them have a fight, these guys would have kicked 1,500 people's asses. I mean, they were nuts. Matter of fact, I was outside. They actually broke a tree that was planted in the ground. They actually broke it, these bikers. Well, they were outside drinking beer, and they had an accord. And the show's getting ready to start, and there's a sign on the door, no beer, no drugs, no whatever. So they start loading the accord back up the counter. I says, fellas, I says, I'm the promoter here. I said, you can't bring alcohol in the building. And he says, well, how about I take every one of these bottles and start shoving them up your fucking ass? I said, well, enjoy the show, you know? So I went inside, and I could not believe it was like going into fucking hell. They had punk rock and wrestling. The funny part was the Cosmic Commander, when he come out to his match, he managed this little blonde-haired guy that done a fag gimmick that if you had shut your eyes, you would think Hulk Hogan entered the building. I mean, I never heard anybody with a bigger pop in my life. I don't know if anybody remembers that. But it was just the craziest thing ever in my life. There was a guy up on stage, and when I tell people the story, they did not believe it. His hair was dyed like this fluorescent fucking red color. And he had his underarm hair dyed the same way. Well, he's standing there singing, and all of a sudden he drops his pants. And the hair on his nuts was the same color as the hair on his head and his shoulders. And I couldn't believe it. I said, this guy's a fucking freak. Well, that's all, you know. I was like, even I was amazed and shocked. I mean, I couldn't believe this was going on. All of a sudden, while he's singing, some guy gets up on the stage and starts blowing him right on the stage. This was in between the wrestling matches. And I'm looking, and I said, this isn't happening. I thought I was like having a flashback or some shit. Then a girl jumps up on the stage, and her head's shaven all the way around in a circle. And she's got a crown of thorns tattoo, where her head was shaved. She takes off her clothes, lays down on the stage, and another girl jumps up on the stage, gets naked, and they start eating each other, for lack of a better term. I just could not believe it was the biggest freak show. And all of a sudden, at the end of the night, I grabbed my kid and I said, let's get the hell out of here. We go outside, we sit across the street in my car. As these 40 riot police cars pulled up, and they went inside, it's the biggest riot broke out ever. Luckily, only one kid got hurt and wasn't serious. But I mean, it was the biggest fight and brawl. And matter of fact, Jim Morianis, who was filming the event, I got to get the tape of him sometime. They actually went up, and he's harmless as a fly. I mean, he just sits there, he don't bother anybody. They actually beat the shit out of him and busted up some of his equipment. That's how crazy it was. It was just the most wildest thing I've ever seen. That was like the biggest show Angel ever done, her and Cosmic Commander. Incredible.
What are some fond memories of Angel that you have?
I knew Angel since she was a little kid. Angel's Angel. She's just, you know, I like her a lot. Down to earth, she's a great girl. Like when my mother passed away, she called me up and talked to me. And I always liked Angel. She's just, me and her had controversy, but we've always remained friends, you know. Her heart was always in the right place, but her mind wasn't, you know. There's probably a zillion stories out there you can tell about her, but, you know, leave them where they're at.
You're doing basically a bunch of sold shows. I guess you went to hit towns in Pennsylvania like Tower City.
Right. Well, that was one of my greatest accomplishments because I did not only, how I got that town was me and the biggest scumbag in professional wrestling, bar none. I mean, maybe you can put Gino, in my opinion, you could probably put Gino Moore in the same category as this guy, was Tom Cassati. Me and him stole that town from WCW because they wanted to come back there because they always done well. And we done real well the first time we went in there. And it was a great town. The guy out there that ran the town for us to help us was a real good guy. He was a former Prudential agent, you know, I knew from the business. He was just a good guy. But we had a great show up there. I loved that town. I'd like to go up there again sometime.
I guess the one incident there is Balls Mahoney was doing the sing.
Yeah.
And basically,
Balls Mahoney, John Reckner, rather. I like him, but, you know, he's had some reservations about me on his interview, but he's the biggest dipshit in the fucking wrestling business. I mean, he has no, his mind's up his ass. They're connected. He was doing the Buddha Singh thing where he was blowing fire. Well, all along he's been using lighter fluid, you know, and it's basically, if you do it right, you can control it and there's not a problem. Well, this one time he changes the lighter fluid, he starts using Thompson's water sealant, which you're not supposed to make contact with your skin. Well, he's putting this in his mouth, and the shit's actually going into his mucous membranes. And he gets up in the corner, he puts Thompson's water sealant in his mouth, and he has like a, he goes into a trance because the shit's fucking his mind up and putting it in his mouth. Well, he goes and blows the torch, and the torch goes flying, lands on the floor, catches a guy's leg on fire, and burns our tarp up. And he's still standing up there, like, in a fucking trance from using that shit. That was unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Any other good stories from Tower City? Town of 312 people.
I wound up beating up Cassati that night, because he overbooked the show, and I told him I wasn't paying for the talent that he overbooked. Of course, Cassati always had money on him, and he would pay the talent out of his pocket just to be friends with him. Well, Alpha Samoa was there, and I'm in the bathroom, and I got Cassati sitting on the toilet, and I'm punching him in the face and choking him and telling him he better shit $100 bills, because these guys ain't going to get paid. And Alpha comes up, and he's going, brother, leave him alone, don't do that to him. He's, what are you doing that for? I said, well, you might as well take over, because he's going to fuck you out of your pay. So next thing, you know, Alpha starts smacking him around. It was funny shit. But Tower City was always a great town. It was a nice long ride up there, beautiful country, and it was a nice town.
Let's talk a little bit about Cassati. I guess you talked about Gordon being a money mark.
Right. Cassati spent his inheritance from his mother on wrestlers. He would pay thousands of dollars just to hang out with the boys. Like Maryland Championship Wrestling, for years, he paid for most of their talent out of his pocket and didn't get a dime from the shows because, you know, he wanted to act like a big shot booker and promoter. He's a sick motherfucker, real sick. Like, I was out in Vegas last year, and he had Inferno Kid and Tommy Fierro. I brought him out there, flew him out there, paid him to stay at his hotel. Well, he got a, they were coming out to go to a banquet where I was receiving an award from the Mullahs group for top independent promoter of the year. And they called me up on the phone, real scared that he had him in the room. He wouldn't let him go, and he had a gun. So, somehow they were able to sneak out of the room, and they brought the police back with them to get their stuff. And when he came to the room, Cassati answers the door. I was standing right there. He had a towel around his waist, and he had shaving cream all over his face except for his eye slots. So it reminded me of like Apocalypse Now at Marlon Brando. It was like the most bizarre fucking thing I've ever seen in my life. I mean, you could tell stories about him forever. Like his mom died one time. Well, his mom died. Well, at the time, not the one time. The time his mom died, we used to call up and crank call before she died, you know, me and Donnie B and my son. Well, the time she died, we had to show up in Yardville, and Cassati was up on a stage doing an interview, kind of promo, and Donnie B had the cordless microphone. He's in the back in the locker room going, "Hello, Tommy, this is your mommy. Where's my money?" And he's looking up in the air like, where the hell's this voice coming from? That mimicked his mom so good. It was Donnie B. It was fucking hilarious. Yeah. But there's a million stories you tell about this son of a bitch. He's like the biggest scumbag.
Any other ones come to mind? Cassati?
Just that he's probably... I've never, with the exception of maybe... Well, not even Gino Moore. More people hate Tom Cassati than anybody in the wrestling. He just totally disappeared off the face of the earth. I think he pissed all his mom's inheritance away, and you know, he was out in Vegas living at the YMCA last time I heard.
Good for him. You did a few shows out in the Minnesota area. I guess two or three shows.
Right.
tell us your thoughts on, like, how you got hooked up going to there.
Well, what happened was, as you know, Sean Walton in X-Pac, he had just, Global just went under, and he was basically doing nothing. I mean, he was sitting on his ass, no one was using him. And I started bringing him in on a regular basis. And while he was out here, he said, why don't we do a show in Minnesota? He said, I can hawk a lot of tickets, I'll get guys out there to help you promote it, we get any Sharky involved. And I said, yeah, let's, we'll try it one time. So there was like an Indian center we had the show at, and the main event was Terry Funk against Hawk. And there was just some great matches on that show. Sabu and 1-2-3 Kid had the greatest match ever in independent wrestling. That was like one of the biggest top tape sellers of all time. And I had Saito from Japan there. I had a whole bunch of guys from Minnesota.
Brad Rangins?
Yeah, Brad Rangins was there. Who the hell else was there? It was just a super, it was a super card. It was unbelievable. And I put Taz out there, Candido. And I remember Taz and Candido out there, and it was just a super show. It was the Indian Center. It was unbelievable. And after that, that was when me and Eddie Sharkey were sending tapes to the WWF, and kind of like we had WWF people at that show, and they fell in love with X-Pac. And then the rest of that, if that's history, you know. We had Jerry Lynn out there. I was using all these guys before anybody was using them.
I guess on your second or third show, you did Lynn versus Sabu.
Yeah, that was the second show.
Okay.
That was the Eddie Gilbert Hawk, which Eddie done the best interviews in wrestling. He was the fucking king of interviews, Eddie Gilbert. He was a great, unbelievable. Matter of fact, I wish Doug was on TV because Doug Gilbert does great interviews too. I mean, if you see his shows cutting promos there, you could tell he was trained by the master, you know. But it was Sabu and Jerry Lynn. And it was funny because Jerry Lynn put a shot on him the whole match. Then after the show, Sabu went up to him in the locker room, and we kind of like had to stand between him because he said to Jerry Lynn something like, hey, brother, you know, this business is a fucking work. What the fuck are you trying to do to me? And Sabu was like, you know, he had a couple cuts and shit on him. I mean, nothing other than normal, but just that, you know. Jerry Lynn didn't help the situation at all. But Jerry's a great athlete. I love Jerry Lynn. I haven't seen him in a long time.
What are your fondest memories of doing the shows out in Minnesota? And why did it just end it when Sean Waltman?
Yeah, Sean left and there was really nobody. I mean, Eddie Sharkey was a great guy. I enjoyed doing business with him. But it was just like when you have shows that far away from your home, you can't control things unless you have someone there that you can really put a leash on him. And me and Sean had like a father-son relationship, and I knew I could count on him to do stuff out there. The thing about Minnesota is the people in Minnesota are as nice as anywhere in the world. They're probably just nicer than people from Tennessee. And I just love being out there. The people were great. A lot of Native Americans out there were real friendly to us, and it's just a great town, except for Prince, you know.
I guess another controversial incident that happened when you were doing the NWA is right before they did the WWF NWA gimmick, Reckless Youth. I guess you and him had some kind of disagreement.
The problem is that when you're in a wrestling business and you have a promoter that's paying the bills, when you're told to do something and he's paying you, you just do it. He got pissed because I put him in a steel cage match with Devin Storm. And I love Tom Carter. He's probably one of the top five guys out there as far as an indie guy I consider. But Tom's problem was he always thought that the business was a shoot. You know what I'm saying? And me and him just started having differences of opinion. And then he told me one day, you know, he said, look, I'm thinking about quitting. I don't know if I want to work for you anymore. I said, well, you don't have to. You're fucking fired. It was just that, you know, he got in his mental frame, which really, but we see each other now, we're best of friends. I like Tom Carter, and I would use him in a minute. You know, he's a great star, but he just needed to kind of, like, grow up a little bit. Unfortunately, I should have taken the Billy Real route with him, you know what I mean? But I didn't. But he's kind of, like, a little bit humble now, I guess.
another incident. ECW starts working with the WWF. They bring in Lawler and Cornette.
Right.
I guess you got to drive the limo that night.
I got the what?
No, you were in the limo. I guess that was one of the deals that, like...
The deal was, here's the deal. Cornette didn't want to do it because he knew it was loyalty to me. But we got talking. He said, I just want to run it by you. The deal was Cornette would get a fat paycheck, and he got a ton of money that night. He didn't want to do it. The other deal was that Heyman would have to pick him up and me up in a limo and take us to dinner. And it was like one of the greatest eating feats ever by me and Jim Cornette, because he took us to Morton's Steakhouse in Philly. And we sat there like 4 hours prior to the show. I mean, we were eating lobster, New York Strip, 4 and 5 appetizers each. We were drinking bottled imported water, and at the end of the night, the guy comes around with a humidor, and he says, "You like a cigar?" I says, "Oh, these are my favorites. They were Monte Cristo, so I grabbed about 7 of them." And I says, "This is great. You get a complimentary cigar after dinner." He goes, "Oh, no." He says, "You got to pay for these." I said, "Well, put them on Heyman's bill." But by the time we got done eating with the tip, everything came to $600. And I went to the arena. Jimmy whacked Tommy Dreamer with a tennis racket and walked out there with a shitload of money. And then they were supposed to give me full access to their town if I wanted it. And I never used it, though. I just wanted to see fucking Paul Heyman grovel a little bit, you know?
You're continuing to sell shows, and I guess, well, I'll have to pray.
We never really sold that many shows. Our shows we promoted ourselves were, we would give the sponsor so much on each ticket.
Okay.
But, you know, if they didn't have a certain amount of tickets sold weeks prior to the show, we would cancel, which we didn't do many cancellations. Because me and Joe Panzerina were packing places. I mean, we were selling out every building we were going into. And we had some good talent. I mean, we had Venus and Snow and David Heath. And we had a ton of draws. We had access to the big giant guy, what's his name?
Silva.
I mean, we just had so much WWF talent available to us that we were packing buildings.
Mm-hmm. You had many guys like right-hand guys you brought up to your business. I guess somebody that you treated like a son was Tommy Fierro.
Yes. Tommy. To this day, there's actually people that think I'm Tommy Fierro's father.
There's a resemblance.
Oh, yeah.
Just during this time, WWF is pulling out some of the guys on the shows last minute, and somebody writes a letter to Meltzer, somebody from your locker room, quote,
right,
unquote.
Right.
And you assume that it's
Tommy Fierro, right. Because I was told by someone who I trusted that a person in a position that should never lie, and he kept telling me all kinds of proof it was Fierro. So I believed him because I didn't think this guy would ever lie. And he turned out to be one of the biggest liars in the wrestling business. But I had a falling out with Fierro over that, but we're fine now. We're best of friends, and Tommy's great. I told Tommy I was Tommy's mentor. You know, I told him how to scam and scheme and do all the shit necessary to be a successful wrestling promoter. And he'll tell you that, you know.
Did you ever find out who wrote the letter?
Yeah, I think I did find out, but I don't have the concrete proof it was him, so I'd rather not say who it was.
That's fine.
I don't want to get these guys sued.
Yeah, thanks.
They could sue me because I don't give a fuck, but you know.
I guess near the end of it down, Tommy does his own thing. You're still promoting the NWA.
Right.
This is like 99.
Right.
You guys start complaining, paychecks are bouncing, stuff like that. Any truth to that?
No, we talking about for the boys?
Yeah.
That never happened. Okay. Yeah, it happened years ago with one guy got a bad check, and it was that fucking idiot, Ralph Soto. He's the only one we ever had a problem with a check, and he's a fucking goof.
You paid him?
Yeah, we actually had to fucking pay him $15. Fucking piece of shit.
Should
have
kept the
$15. He's one of the five guys, I'll give you my top five, he's one of the five biggest shit stains in the professional wrestling, Ralph Soto.
On that note, let's give your five biggest, what you would like to call, pieces of shit in the business.
You got a story.
No particular
in my order. Opinion now, my opinion, number one, without a doubt, number one, Gino Moore. If you talk, this is my opinion now, it's nothing to do with Smart Mark video. If you took a big 6 foot, 500 pound pile of shit and made it with Jabba the Hutt, you would get Gino Moore. He's a pathetic, disgusting, lying piece of shit. He tells people he's been to Japan 56 times. His story, he would rather climb a fucking tree and tell a lie than stand on the ground and tell the truth. He smells, he's fat, he's, I mean, just a pathetic human being. If you look at his, from the neck up, he wears this wig that 25 years ago, did you ever see this like fucking roadkill that lays on the side of the road for about 6 weeks? And then, about 6 weeks, and then like, when it's finally down to its last leg, it's like flat as a thin piece of paper. Well, he scraped it off the road and took it to the dry cleaners. He staples his hat to the top, like I compare him to that mass wrestler, Super Callow, who always has the hat stuck to his fucking hood. Well, that hat and that ratty-ass fucking wig is always stuck to the top of his head. This guy's the biggest, in my opinion, the biggest fucking liar in the wrestling business, storyteller. I mean, hey, Gino, I know you're going to see this. I've seen the fucking film. It's your biggest laugh ever in your life.
Number two.
Tom Cassati. Tom Cassati is the exact alter ego of Gino Moore in the fact that as dirty as Tom, as Gino Moore is, Tom Cassati is clean. Because, like, Tom Cassati, when he was in Vegas, everybody tells us he's got, like, a clean fetish. Like, when he takes a shower, he'll use a whole bar of soap. He'll go through 200 Q-tips. He dries himself off with paper towels instead of a towel. I mean, he uses a whole tube of toothpaste at a time to brush his teeth. And he's really a fucking anal prick. But he's a big piece of shit.
Number three.
Zandik from CZW is another piece of shit. If he didn't have his own promotion, he wouldn't even be working. He's a star in Japan. I know what they're paying the boys over there because I talked to somebody in the office. Some of the boys have to eat at the 7-Eleven over there because they're hardly getting paid shit. And they come back with no money in the pocket. Matter of fact, one of the workers' girlfriends was telling me that they were getting virtually no money, that he couldn't even bring her back a fucking t-shirt. So they act like they got this big thing. What it is if you took Big Japan is one of the worst promotions over there, if you know anybody who follows Japanese wrestling. And they get their few hundred people. They're just like a lousy Jersey independent promotion, but they're in Japan. So right away when you go to Japan, you think, oh, well, it's great, but they ain't shit. You know, they just want some, they needed some American suckers to beat up on. And they went right to fucking Seoul, New Jersey and found them. Who else?
Number four.
Jeff Miller, the Metal Maniac. A lying fucking piece of shit. He ripped my nephew off. My nephew took him off the street. My nephew's friends with the Iron Sheik, and I met Jeff Miller. He was living in his car, and he took Jeff Miller off the street and let him stay at his house and fed him and gave him a place to stay. And while he was there, a month before he left, he racked up an $800 phone bill with calls to Hawaii, and still to this day has yet to pay my nephew any money. You know, he's a piece of shit.
Do you got any pictures of the clown?
Do I have any pictures of him?
Yeah. Take a picture of the clown.
Oh, yeah. Let me think who else is out there. I got Heatwood. There's so many. There's probably 100 of them, but they're like four of the...
one more. Round out your top five.
Round my top five. I'm looking at, thinking about promoters and... so we got Gino Moore, Cassati, Jeff Miller. Oh, of course, I said him earlier. Ralph Soto. Ralph Soto is the biggest piece of shit. He thinks he's a star. He can't walk and chew gum. Don't know the old cliche, a wristwatch from a wrist lock. He's just the biggest piece of shit, too. That's like the top five for now, you know.
How about your five worst enemies? pretty much the same thing.
Well, three of them are in one promotion. Well, two of them. Joe Payton's arena is harmless, but Gino Moore and Fred Rubenstein are on the top of my list. Trying to think who else. I got a lot of enemies. I'm just trying to think of some of them are. There's a zillion of them out there. You know, Zandig. Heyman, I respect Heyman now. I mean, Heyman don't have any problems anymore. For time being, that's what I'm trying. I can't think of anybody else right off this. You know.
I guess around when you're promoting, also Dick Worley was doing some things.
Yeah, he cut his own fucking throat because he was reffing for Vince McMahon, and when Crockett showed up in the area, they went on Good Morning America or something, or Good Morning Philadelphia or some talk show on the air, and they had Ric Flair and guys from the NWA that were coming in trying to fuck with Vince McMahon, and sitting on the set with him right there was Dick Worley. So he was done with the WWF from that point on. Well, he just tried fucking around with me a couple times, and he had this little shit upstart promotion. I ran him out of town. But I see him now, we talk and shit like that, but just, you know, you get a lot of enemies in this business, people you think are your friends, and then you want them to go to war with them, you know?
What led to you being kicked out of the NWA?
I'll tell you the truth, like I told everybody else, I owed him money and I never paid it, and there was a lot of different things why I didn't pay it. I got another rib for you to tell you about. This is one of the greatest ribs ever.
Is this where you bring Ogawa into the States?
Yeah, what had happened was, see, they took Dan Severn off my shows to bring him over to Japan to drop the belt to Ogawa. Now, I felt that they fucked my shows up and I should have been compensated for that. So, because Brody had a sneak deal going on with that fucking crook Inoki and his gang, they took Severn from me and they never took care of me. So, they finally sent Ogawa in and he wrestled in Pine Hill. That was another building I killed. They wrestled there that night. Well, after the match, my son Mark, who's probably the youngest, most brilliant mind in the wrestling business, not because he's my son, he just, as anybody, he knows more about the wrestling business. He's like a young Heyman, Cornette, Gilbert, locked into one. He had a lot of mentors over the year, like guys who were close with him. He was actually close with guys like Terry Funk, and Terry Funk was actually called the house and talked to him. And he learned a lot about the business. And we're outside, he says, "Dad, I got a great idea." I says, "What's that?" He says, "See, before the match, we had Ogawa behind the building teach him how to lock up and do a roll up and a three count, because he never knew any of that shit. So we were actually teaching him behind the building." So during the match, before the match, Doug Gilbert says, "I'm going to get color on this fucking guy. Watch this." He says, so Doug Gilbert got color. And Ogawa actually thought that he was responsible for it and was virtually crying after the match. He felt so bad for Doug Gilbert he couldn't kiss his ass enough, you know? Well, Mark's like, "I got a great idea." He says, "Call Brody and let's start yelling at him and tell him that Ogawa didn't kick out on the three count and Doug was the new NWA World Champ." So I get Brody on the phone. I said, "Brody, you motherfucker, why don't you tell me this guy couldn't speak a lick of English and didn't know how to kick out?" I said, "We got a new NWA World Champ." He goes, "What? Hey, that can't happen." He goes, "That's, we need board of directors approval." I said, "Hey, the fucking guy didn't kick ass. What are we supposed to do?" So Doug gets on the phone and starts yelling at him. Then Mark gets on the phone and Mark's yelling at him. And I said, "Oh," and I get back and I said, "Hold on, Brody, something's happening." So Brody's calling back every minute. We're not answering for him. He calls back. And I said, "Brody, there's a big fucking fight going on. I'll call you back." So next time he calls back, I had all the guys in the locker room pretending we're fighting and blah, blah, blah. And they, I just answered, I opened the phone and didn't say hello, and there's all this shit and racket going on. So Brody's getting the shits now, so he calls a minute later, had this little kid pick up the phone, and he goes, "Who's this?" And Brody goes, "Well, who's this?" He says, "I asked you first." He goes, "Tell me this." He goes, "I ain't fucking telling you. Who are you?" He goes, "This is Howard Brody, president of NWA." He goes, "What are you doing with that phone?" He goes, "I don't know." He goes, "I just picked it up off the ground during the fight." And Brody's like quizzing this little kid about the fucking fight. So Brody keeps calling back and we're not answering. Now he thinks Ogawa dropped the title to Doug. So what happened was we had Mike DiMuzio call, I'll tell you how fucking stupid Brody is. We had Mike DiMuzio, he's the greatest, he's one of the greatest guys in the fucking wrestling. Mike, I love Mike DiMuzio, he's the best, he's like, him and Don, I don't know if you know Donnie Leibel, you heard Donnie Leibel? But if there's ever two ambassadors to wrestling, it should be Donnie Leibel and Mike DiMuzio. Well, DiMuzio gets on the phone, he calls Brody and says he's Captain Mike DiMuzio from the Pine Hill Police Department. Now, fucking Brody don't even connect the name. He's telling him that he better wire up bail because a gal will bust up the fucking place and ain't getting out of jail until the bail comes through to pay for the damage. And Brody's having a fucking shit fit. And we left it at that, so Brody, like a fucking jerk off, calls Inoki in the middle of the night and resigns from the board of directors as president because he disgraced Inoki. Well, the next morning he gets on the computer service and he sees that it never happened. He was hot. That was like one of the greatest ribs we ever pulled off.
So basically, you have to pay money to bring in Ogawa.
Right.
That's some of the money that you owe the NWA.
Right.
So they then vote you out of the NWA.
Right, they did. It was all a big conspiracy between Brody and a guy that I thought was my friend, Fred Rubenstein. But the whole time, Fred Rubenstein was acting like he was my best friend, and he was acting like an attorney, which he wasn't. He was conspiring with Brody and his cronies on the board of directors. They had Rick O'Brien put on the board of directors. It was a Rubenstein stooge. And they iced me out, and they... would not give New Jersey to my son Mark, who legitimately should have had it. They turned around and gave it to Rubenstein and Fat Fuck and Dapper Johnny Falco. And it's just, you know, these guys, I mean, it's just all one big incident of events. My mom died. What do you think of a jerk off that sends you facts Christmas Eve telling you you're off the board of directors? Christmas Eve. And then New Year's Day tells you you're out of the NWA. Then my mom got buried the next day. They were all at the funeral in Avioni, Panzerino and Moore and Rubenstein, and acting like they were my friends. And the day after my mom's funeral, they told me I was no longer involved with the company. And they just, like, you know, they had a bunch of sponsors that were mine. They'd talk, and it just turned out to be a big fucking mess, which I'll never forget. And it's a big fucking joke, because if you talk to the big fucking Fat Fuck himself, he'll tell you, he comes off like he's got the CEO title. And what I'm saying is, if you imagine, like, I don't know if I mentioned this before, you have a Fortune 500 company that sees that professional wrestling is real hot like, through the success of the WWF, and they want to dabble in sports entertainment, and they have their board meeting and invite the CEO from the sports entertainment group, and you get this big fucking 600-pound smelly fucking slob showing up with clown pants in it. Sweatshirt and a super Kalo gimmick sitting in the boardroom with guys that get paid $1 million a year to the head of company. It's the biggest fucking joke in working wrestling. The fucking guy is nothing but my stooge. For years, Gino Moore done nothing but got me my iced tea, which I'm famous for, and carried my bags and drove me around. And now he's acting like he's a big wrestling personality. And anybody that knows him, in my opinion, knows that he's nothing but a fucking liar and a bullshitter. And he's been nothing ever more than a sound man who fucks that up. I mean, a monkey couldn't fuck up DJ equipment. But this fucking fat bastard, he's got excuses for everything. If he fucks up, he'll come back, and you give him shit about it, he'll come back with a lie that the fucking the ghost did it. It wasn't him. And I mean, any fucking lie, it's just, you can't believe a fucking word he says.
You have any more insight to the falling out between you and the other three partners?
Right now I'm laying low. I'm just going to watch them crash land because they don't have talent or shit. They can't draw flies anymore. It's because I'm not involved with them. I mean, I ran the locker room and I put the matches together. Me, my son, Mark, and Donnie B. Donnie B's a great fucking guy. He's one of me and my son's best friends. He's very creative. He comes up with some good stuff. And he's still with them, but... I think what made it better was the three of us doing stuff together. And now that's not there. I mean, look at the makeup. You have a guy that says he was a WWF wrestler. He was a job guy. I don't know how many matches he had. He said he went to Japan 56 times in July. Here's a guy that says he pinned Andre in the Tokyo Dome. And I pinned Hulk Hogan down in Gulf States. A guy don't know shit about the wrestling business, was never considered in the wrestling business. You got him, and then you got Mr. Rogers, Fred Rubenstein, who's not only a lousy referee, but don't know shit about the business. But him and Gina Moore got that special thing in common. They like to expose business. Like if you say, hey, I'm going over to see, I'm going over to have a drink with Hulk Hogan. Oh, you and Terry Bollea. He's like, they drop names and use the, you know, they can't say, well, I could tell Hulk Hogan, hey, or, you know, ask him if you remember when I pinned him down in Gulf State, you know, and you got two guys of the biggest marks. One's a lousy referee and a big mark. And one's just a big slob who constantly exposes the business to impress. He surrounds himself with retards and village idiots because he can't impress and bullshit the normal human being that's got any kind of intelligence. And about Dapper Johnny, one thing about Dapper Johnny, he's blatantly honest too. He won't lie to you. I mean, he'll skim the box office and steal from you and shit like that, but he won't lie to you. But, you know, it's just a real volatile mix, a real volatile mix.
What are your thoughts on the future of the NWA?
I think without me being in it, they're fucked. There's nobody that brought charisma or controversy to the organization like I did. You know that. Nobody did. I mean, nobody got anything going as Barons. Look at Howard Brody. He's about as exciting as a diarrhea in a fan. You know, and Inoki, well, he's got a thing going over there, but he don't know what the hell's going on. We have $300 million, I guess you don't give a shit. And none of them got anything going. I mean, really, it's just, you know, it's a shame because they got some good members. They got Jim Miller, Ernie Todd, Dave Republic. They got some good members, but a majority of them are a bunch of dumb fuck nuts. That's what they are, you know. They couldn't promote pussy on a troop train.
One of the things we talked about, we never like got that story before. The last Gilbert Memorial. WWF, I guess, pulled out their talent.
That wasn't me. Yeah, that there, what had happened was, that was a clusterfuck because Dapper Johnny was under the impression, see, when they tell us, yeah, we can have these guys, WWF would say, yes, they're available. And we were always on the assumption that if we advertised them, we would get them. Well, we started advertising a bunch of them, and the office found out about it and got pissed, and it was nothing different than what we'd done before. But we changed all our advertisement, and they were in the process of getting out of third-party wrestling because they were having problems with other promoters. I mean, they never had a problem with Blaine DeSantis or Jim Kentner or me and Panzerino. It was problems with other fucking promoters. That, like, an example, there's a beautiful WWF valet. I won't mention her name. She was supposed to do a third-party appearance, and she was promised that they would pick her up in a limo. Well, the guy shows up in a beat-up old station wagon with two of his buddies in the back seat. So, that didn't go well. And then this other guy had WWF talent on his show, and during the match, this one guy whipped his dick out, and got back to the office because everybody thought it was a WWF show, and he gave the office a bunch of shit about it. So, that's what killed it for guys that, you know, we had a good relationship with them. Me and Panzerino worked real well with them.
Even Doug Gilbert didn't make it to the last Gilbert Memorial. What was his
name? I forget what happened with that, but I didn't get into it. Just, you know, Doug and me's best friends. Matter of fact, he was on my machine when we took a break a little while ago. I love Doug Gilbert. He's just a great, I mean, I love Doug as much as I did Eddie. I'm becoming closer with Doug than I basically was with Eddie, you know, and I have a great time with Doug's. Like, there's a few people in the business that are great fucking people, like Jim Kettner in Delaware and Blaine DeSantis. And I'm starting up again. I got my promoter in exile thing going. I'm dealing with a guy named Don Margiotto who has Garden State Wrestling Alliance. He's a great guy. You know, Cornette. And there's just a lot of people, you know, that are real good in the business that are good for the business. But, you know, there's guys that fuck it up. I mean, I got a lot of young up-and-coming stars I'm just, you know, I'm all excited about. Guys like Billy Real and Inferno Kid and Felipe and Ratchet and, you know, I'm using the Haas brothers and, you know, guys that are going to be stars like Low Key and There's just a lot of good young stars out there, and a lot of good people that are still left in the business, but, you know, it just ain't the same, you know. I'll be getting started back up again, and all these little neophyte assholes in Jersey, I'll be fucking with them like I did with ECW, so be prepared. I'm gonna put things under control in Jersey again. See, when I was running on a regular basis, you didn't have all these fucking idiots and goofs because they were scared of what I could do to them. Now that I'm not there, they're just, like, multiplying like fucking minks, you know what I mean?
I'll mention somebody's name. You give me, you know, memory, thought, whatever. We'll start with probably the biggest name in the business, Vince McMahon.
Vince McMahon, without a doubt, is the greatest mind in professional wrestling or sports entertainment ever. He is so, I mean, he's in a league by himself. He has done for professional wrestling what no one ever dreamed he would do. Like, everybody thought when Hulk Hogan left, no one could ever be as popular as Hulk Hogan. But he, look what he's done with The Rock and Austin, and they're all way more popular than Hulk Hogan was or ever will be. So, I mean, his marketing, he's just unbelievable. He's a genius. I wish sometime I had the opportunity to sit down with him for a couple hours and just talk, because he's incredible.
Eric Bischoff.
Never met the guy.
Your thoughts on how he runs his business?
I don't think he has a fucking clue. He's more concerned about getting himself over than the guys that he's promoting. I don't think he has a clue anymore.
Chris Candido.
I've done more for Chris Candido than anybody ever in the wrestling business. I pushed him harder than anybody. Nobody wanted him. I used to tell Jim Cornette, I got this kid, Chris Candido. You got to see him. He, without a doubt, was the most incredible wrestler I ever had. He was the best out of any of them. I mean, I had a lot of good guys come through my company, but there was no one ever as good as Chris Candido. Nobody. As a matter of fact, he's probably one of the best in the business. Unfortunately, he's just a little short, but and he's got his own demons, you know, with her and whatever. But no one ever wanted to use Chris Candido. I mean, I got him down in Memphis with Lawler, and then Cornette didn't even want to be bothered. I used to send tapes down, and one time I had a double shot, and I booked Cornette on the show, and I said, he says, who am I managing? I said, Chris Candido, and he said, I knew you were going to do that. And after that, Jimmy fell in love with him and took him right back to Smoky Mountain with him, and the rest is history. It's just unfortunate that the thing with Chris Candido, and I'll tell this to him through his fucking face, it's the old situation is, I haven't talked to him in years. I ran into him in a restaurant about a year and a half ago for 15 minutes, and he hasn't called me one time in like 4 to 5 years. So it's the old, what can you do for me today? I'm really disappointed how our relationship had won, because he used to actually call me Dad. You know, it was funny, and I loved Tammy, and I loved him, and they were like, they were my two favorite people that I pushed more than anybody ever in the wrestling business. Him, you know, not her, but him, and just I feel like he's totally disrespected me and dissed me over the past 4 or 5 years.
Tommy Gilbert.
Tommy Gilbert's a Gilbert. I love Tommy. He's a real strong person. He's a good person. Like, if you ever have a problem and you got something on your mind and you don't know how to handle it or you want to deal with it, you call Tommy Gilbert, because he's like the old sage. I mean, he makes you feel good and gives you alternatives to help you. He's just a great guy. I love Tommy Gilbert.
One of your guys who helped you out on the side for a long time, Paul Adams.
Jeez. All right. What happened was, I brought him down here to work for me, and he didn't have a place to stay, and we were doing a lot of shows, and he was real hot. Paul Adams is a genius, but in my opinion, he's a fucking drunk. And he got hooked up with Ed the Razor Seal. He was another shit stain on the wrestling business. He was living at Ed the Razor's house, and Ed the Razor had him turn on me. And then he just stopped doing shit for me and turned into a real fucking ass wipe. And I think if I still see him to this day, I'll hit him over the fucking head with a bat. I'm a little drunk.
Another one of your...
Also, I think he's he's a card-carrying member of the Burt Prentice Club, if you know what I mean.
I want to bring up Burt Prentice while you're at it.
Met Burt one or two times in my entire life. He's a Burr Prentice is Burr Prentice. I can't say nothing about him because I never really had any interaction with him other than one time he was trying to fuck Ricky O up in North Jersey, and Ricky O was like a son to me, so I had to go intervene and kind of like let Burt know that his options were very fucking limited.
Donnie B.
Donnie B's like, I love Donnie B because he reminds me so much of my son. Like, him and my son, Mark, are the two biggest hate mongers. If they got a hard on for you, forget about it. And him and Mark just, you know, I get a kick out of them. They're like two little kids. They pull ribs on everybody. Donnie's creative. The thing about Donnie, which people don't realize this, is that he's so versatile. He can manage. He can book. And he can wrestle. He's a great wrestler, too. And he's just, Donnie's a lot of fun to be around. Well, sometimes he's radical and, you know, does shit that you wonder why the hell he did it. And he probably wonders why he did it. But he's just, you know, he's a good friend of the family, and we always liked Donnie. And I protected him as much as I could while I was with NWA. They always wanted to get rid of him, and I wanted to keep him. And because one thing about him, like, you look at him, you don't think much, but he'll fight for you. Like, I had him in the locker room. Like, I had guys fuck with me before, like, you know, like J.R. Ryder, another fucking goof. He was fucking me one time, and I sicked Donnie on him, and he just fucking backed down. I mean, Donnie will fight anybody. It's the thing about him. And, he's just a good guy to watch your back, too. He's just, I think that the problem with him not going anywhere right now is he's just got a couple things he's got to straighten out, you know, with his attitude and stuff, you know.
One of your referees you used for years, Mike Keener.
Mike Keener is the greatest fucking guy. If you have a list of great guys in the wrestling business, you put like Jim Kentner there and, you know, Blaine DeSantis, and Mike Keener is the most incredible guy in the world. I love Mike Keener. He's a great guy. It was like one of the saddest days ever in wrestling when he was leaving. Mike Keener's just he's a gem.
One of the guys that you had the vision to know where he'd move on, Steve Corino.
Yeah, it's so funny because I could sit here for 2 hours and tell Steve Corino's story. Steve Corino's like the best. He's another guy that don't call me anymore. Corino, you asshole. I know you're going to see this, and you don't have to fucking call me because I told you you would never call me anyway, so I'm not disappointed. You're a dick for not calling me, but, you know, busy sucking Dusty Rhodes' ass. Steve Corino, funny thing about Steve Corino, when he first started out, I used to get pictures in the mail, 8x10s of this young boy. No names on the pictures. It was just a guy from his waist up, his young kid. And I thought somebody was fucking with him. He sent me kiddie porn. But there were promo pictures of Steve Corino. That's how young he was when he got in the business. But Steve Corino is he's a great interview. He's a great wrestler. He's got a great mind. He's just fucking incredible. And I think you'll eventually see him with one of the bigger feds. I think eventually you'll see him in the WWF. Definitely.
Alan Barry.
Oh, I love Alan Barry. He's like one of my, me and my son Mark love Alan Barry. I can't say nothing about him about the fact that he's great. He's in that list there with Mike DiMuzio and Mike Keener, and he's just a great fucking guy. I love Alan Barry. He's one of my favorite people.
Brian Hildebrand.
Brian was one of the first people I started out with in the wrestling business. I used to bring him in all the way from Pittsburgh. I love Brian Hildebrand. It's a shame I never made it to his viewing or funeral, but like, he was just a great, great guy. My mom, you know, like, it's funny, when I walked in my mom's house, I walk in her bedroom a couple times, you know, get something or see how she was doing, and it's just pictures of all her grandchildren all over the place. It's like a memorial to her grandchildren. And the only other picture she has there is a picture of her and the Ninja Turtle. It's so fucking funny, you know? That was one of Brian's stories we used to talk about before he passed away. I love Brian. I'm going to miss Brian. I get bummed out just thinking I'm never going to see him again.
Talk about some promoters. Jim Kentner.
Jim Kentner, his building is what ECW Arena built, is to Paul Heyman. It's another magical building. Jimmy don't use no big names. He's like one of the greatest minds with stories and angles and He's also an accomplished wrestler. I mean, look what he's done with the Haas brothers. I mean, you know, he's got them at peak now, from training them 3 or 4 times a week. But Jimmy's got that one building he runs a month, and he sells it out every month, and he does well, and he uses local storylines. And he's the first guy ever to use the Kentner-tron. The WWF never used the Titan-tron. Kentner had that first, and now all these other promoters are trying to get it. You know, they're copying the shit. But the thing is, which is, amazes me, and if somebody at the WWF sees this, please hire that guy, because he's got more talent than you can imagine. He will help you so much with storylines, and he's just creative.
Blaine DeSantis.
Blaine's a great guy, too. Me and Blaine used to have heat, and over the past couple of years, we've bonded over food, our two favorite things, and we're great friends, and I love Blaine. He does a good job up there where he's at. And he's just a real good guy that loves the business.
I guess somebody early on, they dealt with Crockett.
Jim Crockett's the biggest cum stain. He goes on that list. He goes on that list with fucking the other jabronis I named earlier. I forgot all about him. Here's a guy that was so rich that he actually looked down on people. This guy at one time was worth $40 million. He owned the New York Mets farm team. Him and his sister, they owned the fucking world. And he just blew his load from being an asshole. See, he didn't like me because he thought I should bend down and lick his boots when I used to bend over and tell him to kiss my fucking ass.
New Jersey's favorite son, the Iron Sheik.
The best, the greatest personality in professional wrestling. If I had another hour, I'd do Iron Sheik stories. He is the fucking best. We love him, man.
Why don't you give us a few?
I just said I'll give him one most recent one. I laughed my nuts off. I'll tell you one thing. I had him come to a ring one time, and I said, listen, you got to learn this dance, the Macarena. I said, Tommy Fierro will teach it to you. So Tommy Fierro actually taught him the Macarena, and when he came out to the ring, he was doing the Macarena, and after the ring, he fucked everything up with it. I mean, totally butchered it. But they went nuts that I actually had a Macarena contest the next month with the Sheik in it. We packed the place, but his consumption of chemicals are legendary. I mean, it's just, I could tell you a zillion stories about him. They all revolve around
the gimmick.
Hashish and opium, yeah. Like this one guy calls him up a couple weeks ago and he says, hey, Sheiky, I want you to work for me down here in Florida. He goes, all right, Bubba, $750 and the airplane ticket. He says, send half the money now, half the airplane money, Sheiky be there. He goes, well, I don't want to pay you that much. He says, I don't want to pay you $400. He goes, oh, no way, I don't leave the house for less than that. He goes, maybe $500. The guy goes, nah, he says, I'll tell you why. He says, I'll pay $400. I'll give you a little opium and some hashish. He goes, all right, Bubba, $400 with a little on the side. He's just the greatest fucking guy in the world. I love him. I love the Sheik. He don't draw any or nothing, but he's worth bringing in and hanging out with because he just fucking makes you forget about all your problems. He's just a great fucking guy.
Devin Storm.
Devin Storm. I started him out in the business. I love Devin Storm. I'm glad he's doing well with WCW. He's making a ton of money. He should be with the WWF. They missed the boat on him. He applied to be a
physical
therapist plus wrestle for them. And they went and hired that other guy just to do physical therapy, that little skinny guy with the long hair. You know what I'm talking about? They had a little thing on when they hired him. When they could have hired Storm, who not only wrestles great, but is a physical therapist. And they missed the boat on him. And Devin Storm, so much, when he first started out, I booked him on his very first show. It was up in Hoboken or one of them towns up there. No, it's where Jersey All Pro runs. What's the name of the town they run in all the time?
Bayonne,
yeah. It was Bayonne. I had him on the show up there, and it was the first time I met him, and he gave me that pussy wrestler handshake. I said, come on, give me the rest of your fucking hand, you know? And he got in the ring, and this guy's, like, doing shit. I'm missing a lot of shit, but, like, I said, this guy is fucking incredible. I said, because he's 6'4", he weighs 250, and he's fucking doing these moves that only a nut would do. So then he started calming down his act a little bit, and then I brought him in with Sabu in the Armory in Woodbury in the main event. We sold the place out. It was like one of the greatest matches ever, and he just he's just changed and done so much for himself that he's not wild and out of control anymore. But for a while, he was totally fucking crazy with that shit. Well, he left me and went to ECW. And I told him, I said, Chris, I said, you made a mistake because I know they're going to outright fuck you. And he didn't want to hear it. And he didn't listen to me. And all he did was just shit on him all the time he was there.
Sabu?
Sabu's a great guy. He's another home run hitter that after he hits it, one goes off in the left field. I was the first guy in the States to use him. He's a good friend. He's just, I love Sabu, but sometimes he's just confused, you know. But he's a great guy. I talk to him all the time. We're best friends. I haven't seen him in years, but I'll hook up with him eventually. I'll start probably using him again with he gets done with his legal problems with ECW.
Abdul the Butcher.
Abby, he's a piece of work. He's probably the greatest hardcore legend ever out there. There's nobody better than Abdul the Butcher when it comes to blood and guts and barbed wire and, you know, power saws and shit like that. He's the best. But I brought him in. The funniest thing about him one time, he'd done a shoot tape, and all he did was mouth me on it and run me down because he thought I was John Arezzi. He got our names mixed up, you know? But I like Abdul. Abdul's, he's another one that's smart to the business and can teach you a lot also.
Chris Benoit.
Chris Benoit is, I like Chris a lot. I used him. He was sitting home in Canada doing nothing. He was just working in Japan and nobody was using him. WCW stopped using him. He was basically sitting home painting. And I called him up. I said, listen, I want you to cut some shows. I want to use you on. We discussed the money. I brought him in. I must have booked him on about a dozen shows. Some of the best runs I ever had at the Armory. Believe it or not, it was Benoit Lawler, Benoit Sabu, Funk Benoit. I mean, we had some great runs there. And one time, Paul Heyman calls me up right before the fuck with the belt, and we're talking. He's, you know, he says, I'm going to steal him from you. I said, I hope you do. You more work than I can. I never begrudged. But, you know, he then went with them, and he got more exposure in the States, and he became a star. But he was funny because him and his father came in one time. I took him to this Italian restaurant in my area. They wanted to go see the Hood. I just thought this thing, you'd hear shit about the Hood. And it's just nothing but a bunch of fucking junkies and idiots sitting on cars drinking beer and drug dealing. You know, it was like nothing. So, you know, had him a tour of the Hood in North Philly.
Dick Murdoch.
Dick Murdoch was great. Dick was the craziest motherfucker I ever met in the business. I love Dick Murdoch, though. He was a lot of fun, but he was just nuts. And I tell you what, legitimately, he was probably one of the toughest guys in the business. He could probably beat anybody's ass. Dick Murdoch was a... The thing I like about Dick Murdoch is what you see was what you get. There's nothing phony about him. And I'm going to miss him because I really like Dick Murdoch.
Terry Funk.
Terry Funk, he was kind of blackballed from the business when I brought him in. Nobody wanted to use him. And I brought him in, and after I started bringing him as an independent, everybody else started to want to use him. I like Terry Funk a real lot. I mean, he's like a mentor to me. He's another guy. If you have any questions or problems with the business, you can call him. He's a wealth of information. I love Terry. I like his wife, Vicky. I mean, he's just a great guy. You know, it's amazing that, you know, how two brothers have completely different wives. You know, Vicky's like an angel and a saint, and Maury's a fucking retard.
You're out of the NWA. You start running your own shows. I guess you did a show February, March.
May.
May.
April? Yeah, Corn State Wrestling on Don More Jaws.
April. You get pleasure out of fucking with people. You say Billy Reel's the new NWA Junior Heavyweight.
I never said that.
Or that's the story.
I did not sanction that match. But Billy Reel is the legitimate NWA Junior Heavyweight Champion because he beat Ratchet and no one had beaten Ratchet up at the time. And I don't give a fuck if the NWA recognizes it or not, but Billy Reel is the NWA World's Junior Heavyweight Champion. And he's going to stay for a long time because they ain't got the balls to send somebody into wrestling.
So I guess that sent Howard Brody off the deep end.
Fuck Howard Brody.
Your thoughts on Howard Brody?
Like I told you before, personally, I like Howard Brody. I really do. But business-wise, in my opinion, he's a fucking idiot. You know, nothing about the wrestling business. He's good at paperwork. That's my assessment of him. That's about it, you know. He can fuck up any angle imaginable. Just, you know. one of his ideas. I think he's the one that fucking killed the WWF NWA thing, because he kept calling up there with ideas, and they were tired of him calling every 5 minutes. That's what I had heard.
What are your thoughts of how the internet has affected the wrestling business?
Well, I don't bother. I don't go on the internet. The only thing I know how to do on a computer is insurance rates. I don't know. 99% of the people that go on the internet are fucking retards anyway, who fabricate shit and, you know, not the use guys who go on the internet. I don't know if you do or not, but like, there might be a million people out there, and you're not, you know, you might be falling at 1%. But they're a bunch of fucking retards, and that's perfect. That's the perfect stage for somebody like Gino Moore. You know, let's tell gossip and rumors and, you know, oh, I heard King Kong Bundy died last night, you know, and shit like that. People call me up and say, oh, this guy ripped you on the internet. Who gives a fucking shit? Do you go in the chat room on the internet? There's like five people there, I think, you know, who cares?
What are your thoughts on the state of independent wrestling in New Jersey?
Well, independent wrestling in New Jersey right now is fucked up. It's like... I consider it like the mob. Like, did you watch the movie The Godfather? When he got shot and wound up in the hospital and they killed Santino, all the different crime families started feuding and coming out of woodwork and doing goofy shit. That's how it is with professional wrestling in Jersey. Like, when I was on top of the game, everybody was under control because they knew I'd fuck with them. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I'm going to get back in that position again where he's a little rinky-dick son of a bitches that shouldn't be promoting. You know, there's only a few guys in the state that should be promoting. I mean, NWA Jersey should promote. Promoter does a lot of shows, a guy named Tom Rumsby. He's a good guy. Cousin Luke. You know, there's a few promoters that are good. But there's a lot of them that ain't worth a shit. And I'm going to get them all under control and start running again and screwing with people.
Dave Meltzer.
I told you, Dave Meltzer's a great guy. I mean, we've been friends for 15 years. He's the kind of guy you can call up if you have a question about the business. He's got more insight. He's got more insight than anybody that's never been in the business, other than a writer. He's unbelievable. And he's a good friend, too.
What do you feel was your greatest success in the wrestling business?
Promoting with him, you know, with some sanity. Not going nuts, using guys that can draw while building up young stars. That was the philosophy that, you know, I guess from Larry Sharp, that you get that names to be the hook, to bring the people, and then you have them watch your young guys, and then that was success. And let me tell you something. I've had dogs, and I've had some great shows. I've done some of the best independent shows ever, and I'm going to get back on track with them again. I'm going to run all these old pissants out of Jersey. You know, guys that shouldn't be promoting these fucking backyard assholes. I might go on a quest to fuck with Combat Zone next. I haven't decided.
What's your biggest failure, you think, in the business? One event.
I've had a lot of failures. I think that's disappointed me most in the business. Not so much a money maker or a loser. That never really was some of the people that... You think your friends that fuck you, guys that you pushed, that you think are loyal to you and give a fuck about you. They don't bother with you once they make it to the top. Not that I always had a saying: a man can accomplish almost anything he wants, as long as he don't care who gets credit for it. You know, and I've always felt like I never say, well, I got that fucker there. He didn't do. You know, he don't know me now. I don't care about that. They got up there, good for them. You know, if they don't, you know. I don't get credit for it. I don't give a shit. I just know that what I did helped them, and they know what I did help them. But basically, the failure is trusting too many people that you think you're friends, and there ain't too many you can trust in this business.
If you had the opportunity to change any one thing you did in the business, what would it be and why?
Be more focused and take better control of things. Like before, I let too many people do too many things and it fuck things up. But by having better control and remaining more focused and disciplined on it, and you know, it's only going to help me on the next round.
We'll get back to some of your top five towns you killed.
All right. Want to do it right now?
Yeah, right now.
Let's see. I would say Pine Hill, Bordentown, Yardville, one of the biggest buildings I killed was down in Maryland, the one that MCW used to run, near the bingo halls. I killed that building. I'm trying to think if I killed anything over in Pennsylvania. Yeah, I probably did. Oh, I killed the building up there in...
Shenandoah?
No, Shenandoah was a good town. Someone else killed that for me. Right up there in, off of 95, we're near Rock...
Fairless Hills?
Fairless Hills, yeah, there's another building I killed. That's like the five.
Top five guys you feel, up-and-coming wrestlers. You don't have to limit it to five.
Billy Real, the Haas Brothers, Inferno Kid, Loki. One guy I really like out there is a young up-and-coming guy. I think he's got a lot of potential. He's got to get bigger and get down to business a little more. It's Ryan Wing. I like him. Kenner's got a lot of young up-and-coming guys. They're the guys I basically use. They're the guys that I think are going to be stars in the business someday.
With the state of New Jersey trying to legislate it, you've been through both sides.
Right.
When it was a free territory to run and then also when they were legislated. What are your thoughts on that?
I think they should have regulation for pro wrestling. It would get rid of all this backyard shit. It would keep these little neophyte promoters that can promote a show in their backyard. It would get rid of all the unsuccessful promoters and the guys that know what they shouldn't be in the fucking business anyway.
What are your present goals in wrestling?
I want to get back in it. I want to cut down basically on the number of shows that I do and do better, more quality shows. That's the thing I have to do until it gets really back up. It's on a downward trend. Independents are basically, a lot of them are dead. And what killed them is these little assholes that don't know how to promote, you know. And guys that do know how to promote aren't promoting, you know. Like, look at NWA Jersey. They have no talent. I mean, you know. I mean, they have Devin Storm, they bring him in Crowbar, but who, I mean, who the hell, you know what I mean, who else do you want to see on their show? I mean, it's the same thing, Axel Rotten, Chris Candido, they're old ECW guys, people don't want to see them outside of that realm. They want to see them, you know, they're just like, they don't mean nothing anymore. Not to pick on, I'm just using a couple of them names because no one wants to see them, you know, and they're pushing like their champ's a guy to Equalizer. He's another dipshit. Yeah, he's come to my shows wearing ECW shirts. I used to throw him out of the building.
Right now you call yourself basically the promoter in exile. Why?
Right. Well, basically I am in exile right now until I latch on to another federation and get some shit going. I'm doing stuff with, I'm getting Don situated with Garden State Wrestling Alliance. And he's going to do well with it. And I plan on doing everything with him pretty much in the future.
You talked about your son a lot during the video,
right.
Mark. Now that he's involved in the business, what impact will your past actions, practices have on his ability to be successful?
He's got my, right now he's going to go to Temple. He's gearing up for that. He's not really screwing with wrestling. But Mark has my, my viciousness in him and my ability. Like, you know, he learned from the master, but he's more controlled than I am. You know?
Any
more level-headed than I am.
Any last comments, thoughts?
Nah, just like I said, I'm back and getting shit started up again, and all these little assholes that are running throughout Jersey now. You know, have fun while it lasts, because they're going to be much longer. And I'll be back being the Don Corleone of Jersey wrestling, you know. And like I said, there's a couple promotions I want to start seriously fucking with. Just for shits and giggles, you know. It don't cost me nothing, but, you know, it's a lot of fun.
All right. Thank you very much.
Great. You're welcome.